children.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. You are invited to take control of the airwaves. Just dial on in toll-free here, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Joining you tonight, it's Ian.
Danica.
And Daryl.
And, of course, you can join us online anytime over at freetalklive.com. There's some interesting internet-related news here tonight. Daryl, you've got a story about the NSA being sued by Wikimedia.
Yes.
And I have a wiki-related story as well, where the New York Police Department has been caught red-handed manipulating information on Wikipedia. So let's start with the NSA, and then we'll go a little closer to home.
So before Certainly. We get started with that, yes. So there's Wikimedia and Wikipedia. Now, I know Wikipedia is the so-called the internet dictionary.
Encyclopedia.
So, encyclopedia, yeah. Thank you. So Wikimedia would probably be an encyclopedia for media-related things?
No. Wikimedia is the foundation that runs Wikipedia and Wikicommons and
okay.
several other entities that are wiki something.
I see. I didn't realize that Wikimedia was an umbrella that incorporated all that. I always thought that Wiki was always by itself.
Plus, an update on the Liberty Dollar situation with Bernard von Nuthaus, the founder, being found guilty. There's an update about what's going to happen to the confiscated silver and gold.
Ooh.
So I've got that story.
Auction? U.S. Marshals?
I'm not going to spoil it right now. The toll-free
Can
number,
I buy some?
Well, I don't know. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. It is considered contraband, as I understand it.
So, not technically. It's only contraband if you try to pass it off as regular dollar.
So we can get back into that here when we get the chance. Our toll-free number again is 855-450-FREE. So tell me about the NSA story, Daryl W. Perry.
So the story here comes from the BBC, and I find it interesting that some of the more major news stories about what's going on in the U.S. we have to get from overseas. So the story here from the BBC says the NSA's mass surveillance program violates U.S. law on freedom of speech, alleges a lawsuit begun by the Wikimedia Foundation. The legal action has been filed against the spy agency and the U.S. Department of Justice. The legal action, co-signed by 8 other organizations, seeks to end the NSA's large-scale surveillance efforts. The foundation is
Good
the...
Good luck with that.
Yeah, well, hopefully they wind up having better success than previous lawsuits because at least this time the NSA has, or rather the person suing the NSA has evidence that they have been targeted by the NSA.
The NSA do something wrong? Say it ain't so.
The foundation is the nonprofit group that oversees the running of Wikipedia, the online encyclopedia. The Wikimedia Foundation said it was taking action against the NSA's so-called upstream surveillance work, which targets communication with people not in the U.S. They claim that such spying violates U.S. laws on free speech and those that govern against unreasonable search and seizure. The scale of the monitoring carried out by the NSA has been revealed in documents made public by whistleblower Edward Snowden over the last 2 years. Some of those papers show the NSA tapped the internet's backbone network to siphon off data. The backbone is made up of high-speed cables that link large internet service providers and key transit points on the net. Mm-hmm. Lila Tritkoff, executive director of the Wikimedia Foundation, in a blog post announcing the legal action, said, "By tapping the backbone of the internet, the NSA is straining the backbone of democracy." She adds that targeting the backbone means the NSA casts a vast net and inevitably scoops up data unrelated to any target and will also include domestic communications, which violate the rules governing what the NSA can spy on. Information in the Snowden papers.
We know they violate their rules all the time, right? So
yes.
this isn't a surprise. And of course, they're going to say they aren't violating any rules because, well, you know, they can do whatever they want.
And well, it's for your security.
They've actually admitted to having violated some of their own rules.
Oh, really?
Oh.
That's in some of the documents that was released by Edward Snowden,
mm-hmm.
where they admitted in their, I believe it was the DC facility, that they violated their own rules on average 8 times a day.
Well, it was necessary, Daryl. I mean, this is national security. I mean, terrorism. Children.
Well, there was one of the lawyers, I believe, for either the EFF or the ACLU that said it's very interesting that, one, they can violate their own rules because
sure.
the rules are so broad as to where it pretty much allows everything. So, you know, he was surprised that they were actually able to violate something so broad. And then he was also surprised that they admitted to having done so so many times. And 8 times per day, and that's just out of the D.C. office. That's not counting the Utah office or any of the other offices that they have.
Well, it's not like they can be held responsible for it or anything like that. I mean, even if this judge somehow miraculously shuts down the NSA, I mean, that's what they want to have happen, is to stop the spying. Even if he manages to somehow miraculously do that, they'll. It's just ridiculous to believe that that would even be something that could come out of this.
Yeah. So it's going to be interesting to see what actually happens, but at least this time, unlike other lawsuits that have been brought in the past, the plaintiff in this suit actually has documentation showing that they were targeted mm-hmm. by the NSA. There was a lawsuit that was dismissed just a few months before Edward Snowden ever released any documents, and the judge said the plaintiffs don't have standing because they don't have any proof that they may have been spied on.
I see.
So at least now the plaintiff has proof.
So maybe they'll avoid that particular motion to dismiss, but you know, they'll likely be dismissed on some other matter.
Treitkoff further said, by violating our users' privacy, the NSA is threatening the intellectual freedom that is central to people's ability to create and understand knowledge. In an editorial published in the New York Times, Wikipedia founder Jimmy Wells said he hoped that the lawsuit would bring an end to the NSA's dragnet surveillance of internet traffic. The other organizations joining in on the lawsuit include the Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, the National Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers, and the Global Fund for Women. And Ian, tell me if you're surprised by this final sentence. The NSA and DOJ have yet to comment on the action.
Well, no, of course not. I mean, they have no obligation. Even local school boards won't comment on controversial matters.
Right, so. And even if they do comment, all they will say is, we can't comment.
Yeah.
We're pending legal action.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, even if this, again, if this judge actually rules in favor of the NSA, then what's going to happen? I mean, are they going to raise their right hand and put their other hand on a stack of Bibles, swearing they've actually shut down the spying? I mean, how can you really verify that a secretive group like the NSA has actually even done what the judge has ordered them to do?
Do you think that it's more viable that they would be required to pay some sort of fine?
To where? The court?
Yeah. I don't know where the fine would go to, but
it wouldn't make any difference because it's not their money in the first place.
Right, but generally when a government agency harms someone unjustly and a court rules against mm-hmm. them, then they pay a fine to whomever was harmed. So, for instance, when you were wrongfully arrested down in Massachusetts, you wound up getting a check.
In that case, it was a settlement on a criminal matter, but so it's a little
wrongful
bit of a different,
arrest.
Little different.
They violated
legally.
Your rights.
Yeah, that's true. They did, but I didn't actually end up suing them over that. That was just part of the settlement, so to avoid such a suit, in the future.
Sure, of
but
course.
There have been other suits where Carla Garrick, the president of the Free State Project, wound up. I don't remember if hers was a settlement or if she actually sued the town of Ware.
I believe she did sue.
But
she sued the police in
was
the town.
Decided that her rights had been violated by government agents and government agency, and they had to give her money. So that's generally what happens when a court decides
if
that
they
rights
sue for
have
that,
been
right?
violated.
Like, that's not something that the court just decides. They have to ask for it in the suit, do they not? I think
I don't have a copy of what they filed, and it doesn't say this in the article, but generally, you know, they are seeking some type of
Damages,
or...
The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Your thoughts on the NSA are welcome. Free Talk Live.
Indefinite extension of the human lifespan is coming. But is it coming soon enough for you and me? That's the $80,000 question. I say $80,000 because that's what it costs to have your head cryonically frozen by Alcor. I've committed to do it. I got a life insurance policy, and I made them the beneficiaries. Bam, my best shot at living forever. Interested? Contact them at alcor.org. ALCOR.ORG. Mention my name, and I get a free year of membership.
How fast are new Allegra gel caps?
I didn't know you got a cat fast.
How strong are new Allegra gel caps?
10 more logs to go strong.
Non-drowsy Allegra gives you noticeable relief of your toughest allergy symptoms in just 1 hour. 2 times faster than Claritin and stays strong for 24 hours.
It's relief when the pollen's off the charts strong, even in the convertible.
New Allegra gel caps. Nothing's faster. Nothing's stronger. Guaranteed or your money back. Visit Allegra.com. Use only as directed.
Again, the Congressional Budget Office sounds the alarm. This time warns of Greek-style U.S. debt crises. You heard me right. The GAO is drawing a parallel between the U.S. economy, its debt, and the current Greek economic meltdown. With the debt-to-GDP chart climbing into unfamiliar territory, the growing budget deficit will rise to unsupportable levels. Hi, this is Ted Anderson. The Federal Debt and Risk of Financial Crises document the CBO has published is a must-read for every American. Covering the risk of continued deficit spending coupled with an aging population and the rising interest rates spell economic disaster. It's imperative that you get a copy of this document and study it for yourself. Call me today at 800-686-2237, and I'll send you a free copy. Again, call 800-686-2237 and ask for your copy of the CBO document. Once again, you need to read this government report. Call 800-686-2237.
The warning signs.
At first, he made me feel special. He promised he'd look after me, provide for my future. He broke every promise he made.
Millions of Americans afflicted.
I was ready to leave, but he told me he'd change. So I gave him another chance. I was such a fool.
The consequences.
Things only got worse. He started making my decisions for me about my job, my kids' education, my money. My safety, my future. He took away my choices, but I kept going back to the same politicians.
The diagnosis? Battered voter syndrome.
I fell for the same old lies. They were just playing with my emotions, telling me what I wanted to hear. That's not right.
Stop the insanity of voting for the same old abusers. Declare your independence from the two-party system and join the New Hampshire Liberty Party today. At nhliberty.info.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are: one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love, but make sure you give $5 a month to AMP. At amp.freetalklive.com.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolf. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with a chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. We invite you here toll-free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And join us on Skype. Our Skype username here is lrn.fm. You go to coffee.freetalklive.com to get a free pound of some of the best coffee out there from BuzzBox. Shade-grown, 100% organic, top 1% grade Arabica. It's great coffee, and they're doing good work over there because a portion of the profits from each pound will go towards microloans from Kiva.org. It's actually Mark, who is our regular weekday co-host, who assigns the money with the microloan. So he decides, you know, who's worthy of receiving those loans. And, you know, there's all kinds of people around the world and various different difficult parts of the world who are receiving those, which is really cool. So you're helping people and you're getting great coffee and you get your first pound free. Just pay the shipping cost over at coffee.freetalklive.com. And again, that's coffee.freetalklive.com. You can cancel your subscription at any time. We can continue here with Daryl's story about Wikimedia suing the NSA in the hopes of actually shutting down some of the spying program.
The Dragnet surveillance, which is what they're doing where they tap into the backbone mm-hmm. of the internet and then they just collect large swaths of data. So they're getting what they're looking for, plus a lot of other stuff.
Which can be mined for all kinds of information, and then who knows what they're doing with that. But I don't know if that's going to end up shutting down some of the other egregious things that they do. You know, what portion of the NSA's budget, for instance, is used for this particular form of data mining?
Good question.
Yeah.
I do know that a couple of years ago, again, just before some of the Edward Snowden leaks or, you know, whatever you want to call it, there was the vote in the U.S. Congress to defund a portion of the NSA spying stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And that vote wound up failing by 12 votes. So if seven
really?
Representatives would have switched how they voted, then this would have passed.
Let's go to Jack. He's in New Hampshire. You're on Free Talk Live with Ian, Danica, and Daryl. Hello, Jack. Jack in New Hampshire, going once. Jack in New Hampshire, going twice.
Wait.
Hey, we have you. Yes, go ahead. I thought we had you. Jack, are you still there?
Hello?
Hey, you're on the air. I think we're having some technical difficulty.
There must be a huge delay, it sounds like.
Jack,
can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you fine, Jack. I don't know. It seems like you can't hear us.
No, I'm not Jack. This is Dave in New Hampshire. Can you hear me?
Oh, Dave, yes, we have you. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's why there was a delay. yeah, I wanted to call. I guess I heard on the archives, Daryl was talking about how he has a lot of chronic pain and headaches, especially.
Yes.
And I was about to email. Actually, this is something half of Free Talk Live listeners probably need to hear. There's this doctor that John Stossel sort of put through the ringer, you know, to see if he was telling the truth because his story sounded so crazy. He's just a medical doctor in New York, I think, named John Sarno. And his theory is that most pain of this, like back pain and headaches and so forth, is actually caused, it's sort of by suppressed stress, and that you can cure it by just learning of the fact that it is suppressed stress.
Well, I think it's true, just to interrupt you there, I think it is true that a lot of headaches can be caused by stress. I don't know if that's the case with Daryl, who has actually hit his head on a multitude of occasions.
Yeah, my headache started with, I believe it was my 12th concussion, and I've had the headache ever since. And I've actually, you know, bumped my head several times since because I'm clumsy. So mine is because of multiple concussions.
Maybe. Dr. Sarno would say he needs to check you out physically, and you might be right.
Do you think he might be stressed from having all those concussions?
Not necessarily. Sarno believes that many of these cases, the accident is just a trigger, and it becomes an excuse. Your brain thinks that that's what's causing it. It sounds absolutely insane, but I read one of his books, and just reading the book, I had back pain for 15 years off and on, and I haven't had any back pain since reading the book. It's absolutely insane. But if you just Google John Sarno, half of you listening will probably, you know, if you've got chronic pain, would actually find it go away just by reading the book. It's better probably to see him in person, but he's really old. I don't know if he's even seeing patients anymore.
Well, it sounds like it's worth a try. I mean, if chronic pain can go away simply by reading something, I think that's, you know, certainly not off the list of options what people would be willing to do. I mean, obviously some people are uncomfortable taking all manner of pills because it will affect the rest of their life, you know, as far as what they can pay attention to during the day and
sure.
what their personality type is like. And I like where you're coming from, Dave. I do like the idea that, you know, that people manifest physical conditions to some extent. But at the same time, I think there's also an argument for physical damage. But you know, if you can overcome physical damage with positive thinking, then I think that's a good thing, if it's possible.
What happened with me was the pain started when I had a back injury. I had an actual heavy lifting injury. Mm-hmm. It went on and off for 15 years after that. And I thought it was related to that initial injury, but apparently that just wasn't the case. It was a trigger for it. And the other thing is that if we, you know, we want our army to be healthier than the enemy army, right? So the Free Talk Live listeners tend to be people who we want them to be healthier than the bureaucrats, right? So I think this has a liberty aspect. The more freedom lovers who know about this, the more we will be able to peaceably fight effectively without spending time trying to fix back pain or whatever.
Very good. Dave, anything else you want to share?
No, that's it.
Thanks for the call tonight. Appreciate it. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. And now, Daryl, you do have, or you have had relief from marijuana tincture or cannabis tincture?
Cannabis tincture.
Yeah.
If it's the 50-50.
Is that something you put under your tongue? What do you do with that?
Generally, there are several ways that you can ingest a tincture. One of the ways is you can use a dropper and put it up under your tongue. You can put it in like an e-cig sort of thing and inhale it that way. You can add it to food as an additive. What I prefer to do when I do have a tincture is take a bottle of water, mm-hmm. put like a dropper and a half full, swish it around, you know, get it mixed up in there, and then I will just sip on that water throughout the day so that
I'm... That's all it takes, a whole dropper and a half of a dropper.
About a dropper and a half.
In a full bottle of water.
In a 16-ounce bottle of water, and then I sip on that throughout the day. It doesn't make the headache go away.
Okay.
But it makes it light enough to where I can, you know, barely notice that it's there.
That's pretty good.
And it leaves me functional.
Would there be a difference if you took it in one one consumption as opposed to taking it continually throughout
the day? I've tried both ways.
Okay.
And I prefer to take it throughout the day.
Okay.
Because then the medicine is, you know, constantly entering into my system.
Sure, that's what makes
instead
sense.
Instead of all at once. Hmm. And... You know, I've tried smoking, and smoking doesn't help because when you light things on fire, then, you know, that's going to wind up messing with your head. And I've tried various strains, and I found that what works best for me is the indica sativa blend, because then it doesn't leave me, you know, too head high or too body high. Yeah. It's a nice blend of both, so I'm functional. And I don't want to just, like, lay there in a vegetative state.
A dropper and a half in a bottle of water, you're not going to be getting any kind of buzz off of that. That's pure medical.
Yeah.
There's more coming up here in moments. 855-450-FREE, 855-450-3733. Maybe you can tell us your cannabis medical success story. And there's more on the way here on Free Talk Live about the NSA.
By now, you may have heard of... Coins are now over an $8.5 billion market, and did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoin by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely. Securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co, BidBit.co.
This is Tim Austin.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive.
It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here. And I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com.
If you want to move to the free state and you're looking for some real estate, well, I know a guy who's really great. It's the realtor Mark Warden. Do you want a home with 20 acres, a lakeside cabin, any takers for renters, buyers, and sellers too? Mark Warden is the guy for you. PorcupineRealEstate.com.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing, to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. It's physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101ReasonsFilm.com. 101ReasonsFilm.com.
Help get LRN.FM into more ears. Visit promote.lrn.fm for a free bumper sticker, flyers, banners, graphics, and more. Promote.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live, and you can bring up whatever you'd like. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Wikimedia suing the NSA. We can continue talking about that. Of course, you can bring up anything you want. And uncovering the secrets and exposing the lies. That's what readers of FreedomsPhoenix.com get every day. Readers of FreedomsPhoenix.com are constantly provided the detailed real news that lies between the lines of propaganda and the relationship we have with coercive governments. FreedomsPhoenix.com offers up-to-the-minute updates on the economy, technology, communications, and the rise of the police state. Go to FreedomsPhoenix.com and sign up for their free daily dispatch. That's FreedomsPhoenix.com. As we continue with you in studio tonight, you've got me, Ian.
Danica.
And Daryl.
Coming up, the latest on the Liberty Dollar. What happened to the thousands of ounces of silver and gold as well that were confiscated from the once very successful alternative currency operation? We will tell you more about that here in a moment. But Daryl, your story tonight was about the NSA, or one of them, is about the NSA
yes.
being sued by Wikimedia, which, you know, I think that's fine and all. That obviously the Wikimedia Foundation is doing pretty well if they can hire these lawyers, or maybe they're getting them pro bono. That would be really nice too, because they're always raising money for stuff. So hopefully they're not paying for attorneys with the money that, you know, hopefully is supposed to be used for Wikipedia and like,
right.
keeping
and
that going.
Wikimedia, of course, is one of, I believe it was 8 or 9 organizations that are collaborating in this lawsuit.
Mm-hmm.
So then, you know, the cost of the lawyers is spread out.
Good point.
My guess is there's probably a lawyer that's doing at least discounted work, if not pro bono, on this.
Certainly, they'll get their name out if they do it pro bono. I just, you know, was curious about that. I wasn't expecting you to know what the answer as far as, you know, if they're actually paying for this or not.
Yeah, I don't know. The article didn't say, and the article did not link over to any filings.
But of course, you know, whichever the organizations are that are involved here, they can certainly use this as a fundraising option to get out there and promote themselves.
Certainly,
sure, absolutely.
But ultimately, as I was suggesting before, you know, I'm not going to get my hopes up about it, number one, because I can't imagine the judge, whoever he or she ends up being, is going to rule against the NSA. You know, because of national security, the doctrine of necessity will likely come into play to where, you know, if the government can claim, well, it was necessary to break our own rules. I mean, this is national security we're talking about here. They can get leeway for doing that. Because there aren't really any hard and fast rules when it comes to government. Yeah, they've got some words written down on paper, but the rule of necessity is more important to them, and that is where they can use that excuse to do just about anything and to break just about any rule.
Well, Donald said that they would likely be slapped with some sort of a fine
if they're found responsible.
Right, if they're found to be responsible
or guilty, or whatever sort of term you...
And so that brought up another thing you had pointed out. Is it going to stop them from spying, or are they going to have to seize
the dragnet part? Suit itself will stop them,
right?
But the suit could wind up leading the Congress critters to wind up pulling the plug on the dragnet, which is something that they've tried to do in the past, and they came up 7 votes short.
Right, I agree. I don't think it would stop all spying, and certainly I don't think that there would be have that in the power. But if they can pull the plugged from at least Dragnet. I mean, it's a start at least.
Yeah, that's presuming they make it through this lawsuit, which is not very likely.
But even if they don't make it through the lawsuit completely, the media about the lawsuit and the things coming out, it's going to wind up causing some of the people in D.C. to start thinking, hey, maybe we need to bring this up for a vote again on pulling the plug.
So they bring it up for a vote, and Barack Obama vetoes it. Right? I mean,
I don't
it's
know,
hard for me to get excited
because he's
about
not
any
really
of this.
Weighing in on whether or not the dragnet, you know, is something that is needed.
It's not like he's trying to get reelected, right? So either he does the right thing and signs the bill, or does the thing that would favor the government and vetoes it. I mean, it's just hard to really get excited about this in any way, shape, or form.
I get what you're saying.
Yeah, and I'm not saying that you were suggesting I should be excited about it. It's just the news. These guys are suing the NSA, and good for them. And, you know, if it brings attention to the matter, that's a good thing. I mean, there are some good things about this. But I don't think anybody should look at this and say to themselves, this is it. The NSA is going to get the smackdown they deserve, because it's highly unlikely.
I'm certainly not thinking that.
Well, who knows how long this is going to get dragged out for, too.
That's a good point. It might be another half a decade or more before this actually ends up panning out. They probably will hear the case within the next couple years.
Probably
at the district
years.
Court level. But then, of course, it could be appealed and appealed from there. And before you know it, it's a decade later. So there's that too.
No, most of the time when a case goes all the way to the Supreme Court, it's no more than 5 or 6 years.
That's it? Really?
Yes.
Okay, I've never seen any averages on that. I don't know what
I read things.
You see it when you're paying attention. That's
right.
Usually the time
frame. Pay attention to various cases, and there are some times when cases do get dragged out ridiculously long. Like, I believe it was last year when a lawsuit filed by Ralph Nader in 2008 was finally settled. So it was one of his ballot access suits that he filed in 2008 was just settled last year. But generally, it's 5 to 6 years from the time that it gets filed
and how many
until it winds up going
dollars,
to Supreme Court.
If not millions of dollars. I wonder what the attorney's fees on something like that are, going all the way to the Supreme Court. Can't be cheap.
Well, depending on what happens with the Robin Hood of Keene lawsuit, you might find out.
Well, we've actually got a pro bono attorney in that case, thank goodness. But, you mean like for the city of Keene?
Right.
What would it cost them?
Once they wind up finishing all of the litigation, we should be able to find out what the bills are that they paid their lawyer.
Yeah, that's true. So number one, the judge is likely to not rule against the NSA, period. I think it's very unlikely the judge will rule against the NSA. But even if the judge does rule against the NSA and they do somehow miraculously shut the program down, that doesn't stop the NSA. It doesn't stop them from tweaking the program a little bit and, you know, calling it something different.
Yeah, trying to get around it or anything.
Right. Call it something, give it a new name, and
right, and they're not even trying to shut down the entirety of the NSA.
Right, just one specific aspect.
And there have been judges in the past that have ruled partially against the NSA. Mm. So, you know, it has happened. It's not very often.
And they're still violating people's privacy wholesale.
Right. And there are conflicting court rulings of whether or not the NSA has the authority to do what they're doing.
And we only know about it because of Edward Snowden. So right. A lot of this information never would have come forward. And all of the claims about the government spying on people would have been pure speculation. Now we know it's not speculation.
And that's actually why a court threw out a case a couple of years ago, because there was no documentation yet
that it was happening.
The court said the plaintiffs have no proof that this is happening. It's pure speculation. Case dismissed.
Case dismissed.
And then about 3 months later is when the first leak came from Edward Snowden. Mm.
So now here you have this other one. So we'll see, we'll see what happens. Maybe it'll come across your desk again, Daryl, and we'll talk about any updates
certainly
to the case in the future. In other Wiki-related news, however, there was the NYPD was caught red-handed. According to RT, they apparently their computers from their network were editing Wikipedia pages. Some people in the New York Police Department were editing those pages. They probably have a whole propaganda wing, or at least one or two people devoted to this particular task. That's speculation on my part. But according to RT, the NYPD is reviewing reports that computers connected to the NYPD's own network edited the Wikipedia page for some of the more infamous recent events to involve the NYPD, including the choking death of Eric Garner. And that's in, for those who don't recall, the gentleman who was choked to death for allegedly selling cigarettes. The police officer in that case, I believe, has not been charged with anything at all.
That is correct. Yeah. And yep. There apparently were two people that filmed that death.
Oh.
One of the videos became much more famous, and we've heard the stories about he was targeted by the police.
For
the other person that filmed said that she has also been targeted by the police.
Not a surprise. We'll continue with more on what are they doing on Wikipedia, NYPD, and should they be able to edit these articles? You can share your thoughts with us. This is Free Talk Live.
Shiny badges on your jacket. Shiny badges.
This is Davi Barker from ShinyBadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at ShinyBadges.com, write WORMS in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
If the IRS has garnished your paycheck or seized money from your bank account, you need to get professional tax help now. Fast action is required to put a halt to these aggressive IRS collection tactics. You can count on the knowledgeable team of tax professionals at Wall & Associates. With over 30 years of experience, Wall & Associates has settled the tax problems of thousands of taxpayers for a small fraction of what they owed. For a free face-to-face consultation, call 1-800-425-4610 to put a wall between you and the IRS. 1-800-425-4610 or look for us on the web at wallandassociates.net. We solve tax problems. If you hire Wall & Associates today, you'll never have to talk to the IRS again. To stop the levies and seizures today, take action now. Call Wall & Associates at 1-800-425-4610. Wall & Associates, 1-800-425-4610. Based on actual cases, results may vary, not a solicitation for legal services.
Never, ever send a follow-up email asking, "Did you get my email?" Email 101, if it didn't bounce back undeliverable, it got where you sent it. And avoid transmedia pestering, like calling to ask, did you get my email, or emailing to say I left you a voicemail. If your emails and voicemails aren't being acknowledged, your problem isn't technology, it's technique. Is your message concise and understandable? Have you boiled it down to seem as relevant as possible to the recipient? In other words, is it the opposite of spam or junk mail? All of this really matters if you're a job seeker. But even if you're not, with money and attention so scarce now, effective communication skills have never been more important. For more tips, hit survivalspeech.com. I'm Holland Cook.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
Are you tired of governments murdering people around the world? Stop using their money. There is an alternative. Bitcoin is a stateless, free market, non-political currency. Bitcoin cannot be inflated or controlled by any government. By using their money, you are helping the state. Stop doing it. You have an incredible alternative available now. Learn it, use it, spread it. Get started with Bitcoin at weusecoins.com. That's weusecoins.com.
This is the Liberty Radio Network, broadcasting the latest liberty-oriented audio content 24 hours a day at LRN.fm.
Free Talk Live. Take control toll-free here. Bring up what you want. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. The New York police have been busted logging into Wikipedia and changing articles about controversial instances of NYPD police brutality, like the murder of Eric Garner, where he was choked to death, allegedly overselling cigarettes. We can continue with the story here in a moment. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Join us via Skype. It's Skype username LRN.FM. Plus, still to come, the latest on the Liberty Dollar drama, which, of course, started now nearly a decade ago. It's been 8 years, just a little under 8 years since the Liberty Dollar raid. This is the world's most, or at least the United States' most popular alternative currency for a long time, and it was taken out by the U.S. federal government. We'll tell you what the latest is on that case, and of course your calls about anything. 855-450-FREE. The story from, let's see, this is not from Wikipedia, but it is about Wikipedia, RT.com. Reporting, Wikipedia's articles pertaining to at least three individuals who died as a result of altercations with the NYPD, including Eric Garner, were edited out of the department's One Police Plaza headquarters in the capital of New York. Reporting on Friday, according to the publicly available records of the online encyclopedia's revision history, computers connected to IP addresses traced back by the paper to NYPD headquarters. This is the... Oh, I see. Capital New York is a paper. I didn't realize that. CapitalNewYork.com. So they are the ones who did the sniffing here. They went and they examined the IP addresses of the people editing these particular articles. And looks like NYPD doesn't know about ProXPN.
Yeah, because anyone can edit the articles there. It just so happens that the NYPD were doing it. So, oh, why would they want to edit that?
Well, and it would also be interesting to know exactly what changes they made. So, according to the story here...
Well, that can be found out if you go into the history.
That's correct.
You can click the show differences between these two revisions.
Right. Yeah, and it will also show you like how recently it's been edited, too. So, if it's been edited 5 minutes ago, you can think, oh, someone's been busy.
So according to the records, apparently they edited and sometimes attempted to delete entries on alleged instances of police brutality and articles critical of the force's conduct. Along with a page on Garner, the Staten Island man who died last July after being placed in a chokehold by NYPD officer Daniel Pantaleo, Wikipedia articles detailing no fewer than two other deaths involving the Big Apple's Boys in Blue were altered by computers connected to the agency's complex in downtown Manhattan, according to a reporter for the magazine Capital New York.
Now, see, if you're going to be a government agency and have some of your staff, you know, like go mess with Wikipedia articles, there are two things you need to do. One,
use a VPN.
Well, you could do that,
yeah.
Or have them go to the public library, because then, you know, it's not tracing directly back to you.
Yep, that's true. But they're lazy. I mean, these are bureaucrats, and, you know, bureaucrats aren't known for being particularly adept technologically.
True.
Nor are they known for being really interested in, you know, taking extra steps.
Or just tell your, you know, whoever it is, do this work at home.
Wikipedia pages for the NYPD's so-called stop-and-frisk tactic, as well as recent scandals that have tarnished the force, such as the 2013 incident in which an undercover cop was caught up in a group beating on the West Side Highway, were edited from the headquarters, say Capital New York, reporting along with the pages for Garner, Sean Bell, and Amadou Diallo, all of whom died at the hands of the police. Bell died in 2006 after undercover officers fired 50 times. At him and two other men, all unarmed. And Diallo was killed in 1999 when a cop mistook his wallet for a gun and opened fire.
So out of the 50 shots that they fired on the one guy, how many actually hit?
Not clear. I don't have that story in front of me.
Okay.
But enough.
I just know
enough
that
to kill him.
You know, they're not generally good at hitting their target.
Oh, I suspect most of them did not hit.
Because you remember the thing a couple of years ago where somebody went to the Empire State Building and then killed their former boss, and then the cops showed up and fired a bunch of times, and cops wound up injuring like 11 people.
Yep. Yeah, they were just shooting wildly, and they weren't even that far away from the guy.
Right.
Last December, someone connected through the NYPD's network made multiple edits to the Death of Eric Garner page on Wikipedia, said Whale, within hours of a grand jury's decision not to charge the officer with the man's death. Garner raised both arms in his air, Garner raised both his arms in the air, was changed to read, Garner flailed his arms about as he spoke, unquote. Whale wrote,
I don't know what video they were watching, but the one I saw, he was not flailing his arms.
There was no flailing to be had. I mean, yeah, did they try to make him look like that he was some sort of crazy psychopath?
Yes, of course. They want readers to justify the killing of this man. They want it to seem like he was dangerous and trying to harm the police. He's flailing about. It's crazy. More here. Another example of what was changed. Quote, so original quote here, use of the chokehold has been prohibited, unquote, was changed to, quote, use of the chokehold is legal but has been prohibited. Unquote. Instances of the word chokehold were replaced twice, once to chokehold or headlock, and once to respiratory distress, while reported both times from the NYPD network. With regards to the Bell shooting article, a user connected to the NYPD network initiated an effort to have the entry nixed altogether by filing a complaint on the website's internal articles for deletion page. Quote, according to the user, again from the NYPD's building, quote, he, Bell, was in the news for about 2 months, and now no one except Al Sharpton cares anymore. The police shoot people every day, and at times with a lot more than 50 bullets. This incident is more news than notable. Can you believe the callousness of that particular quote?
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, anyone who's actually been to police websites before can believe that. If you've ever been to a site like police1.com, I believe is the name of the site. This is one of the sites that's constantly upset about the existence of copblock.org, for instance. Police One, if I'm recalling the correct site, requires the officer to prove that they are an officer before they will give them an account on the site. So people who have accounts on that site are actually law enforcement officers. They've verified it. You know, that you apply, you say, I'm with this department. Here's my superior officer. Here's the, you know, phone number for the department, you know, certain identifying information. And then
here's a copy of my badge, my employee ID, kind of stuff, et cetera.
They'll check you. And then once you're approved, you get on the site. So you get to see all kinds of really outrageous behavior from police on some of these police websites where they are very clearly callous towards human beings. You know, in this case, saying, oh, this guy, well, there's cops shooting people with more than 50 bullets regularly, so what's the big deal here? Going on here. In 2006, according to Weil, a user of the NYPD network deleted 1,502 characters from the Scandals and Corruption section of Wikipedia's New York City Police Department article.
Wow.
2 years later, another computer connected to the network deleted the entire allegations of police misconduct and the Civilian Complaint Review Board and other incidents sections from the main NYPD page. They've been at this for more than a decade.
Okay, so...
Or about a decade, at least.
Let me sort of play... I don't know if devil's advocate is sort of the right term to use for this situation, but what if this is just a big, elaborate hoax brought about by somebody that just wants to, you know, play a practical joke on the police, like
someone in the police?
No, a hacker that is able to somehow hack into to where it looks like...
Do you think Anonymous is doing it?
I don't think that passes Occam's razor, where that which is, you know, the most likely story will likely be the one that's true. I'm sure I'm butchering what Occam's razor is, but if I've gotten it wrong,
I'm not saying it's, you know, the most likely. Yeah. I'm just saying, you know, it's something that popped into my head, because it would be like a pretty good hoax to carry this on for like a decade to just hack into the NYPD system and go edit a bunch of stuff to make it look like the NYPD is doing these nefarious things.
Has the NYPD even said anything?
No.
Like, have they denied, have they confirmed anything?
They're just saying it's under internal review.
Oh, of course.
That's all.
Yeah, everything that the cops do is under internal review.
Or we can't comment at this point.
Yeah, so they didn't say, well, we don't think that should be happening and we're going to track this down and put a stop to it. They just said, we're reviewing this.
Right.
So they can give the guy a promotion.
Basically, they'll ask everybody, who's been editing Wikipedia at work? And everybody's going to say, not me. Well, we did an investigation and we didn't find anything nefarious.
So this has been going on since at least 2006. An intern with Capital New York wrote that there are more than 15,000 IP addresses registered to the NYPD, and information about them can easily be found online for free. A simple computer script programmed in Python ran those addresses through Wikipedia, she said, and then flagged instances in which edits were made. Very smart. More coming up here in moments. Hour number 2's on the way. What's the latest on the Liberty Dollar? It's actually kind of a questionable situation, so I'm looking forward to getting y'all's input on it. More on the way. It's Free Talk Live.
Well, I did it. I finally left the empire behind. And now that I'm safely settled in Chile, I'm gathering with others like me to build a new community called Fort Galt. Fort Galt is designed to be the ideal home base for professionals and their families to live and work in peace. If you're ready to ditch the superstate and bring your business to freer lands, visit us online at fortgalt.com. That's fortgalt.com.
Nothing compares to a good cup of coffee. But if you're getting your coffee from the store, you're likely not getting a good cup of coffee. Free Talk Live's teamed up with BuzzBox to bring you a free pound of the best coffee, shade-grown, organic, top 1% grade Arabica. But what's different is that for every 10 people that get coffee through our link, coffee.freetalklive.com, we can give another micro-loan through Kiva. When the loan's paid, we lend the money again. Help others, one cup at a time, coffee.freetalklive.com.
Liberty activists around the country are starting to realize politics alone won't set us free. So what will? At Liberty on the Rocks, we believe the answer starts with living your principles, spreading ideas, and connecting with those around you. By starting a Liberty on the Rocks network, you can make a difference by uniting libertarian thinkers. Find out how much fun it is to build your local network from the ground up. Visit libertyontherocks.org today to get started.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number 2 is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Friday, March 13th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.57 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,157 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $291. Antiwar.com reports the Syrian Network for Human Rights has issued a new report in which they determined U.S. warplanes have killed over 100 civilians in airstrikes in Syria since September. Nearly half of the 103 deaths were the result of a single strike on December 28th when U.S. planes attacked a makeshift the Islamic State prison in Al-Bab, killing 51 civilians held therein. The Al-Bab incident was initially denied by the Pentagon and only confirmed 2 weeks later after an investigation by McClatchy. The Pentagon then conceded leveling the building, but said they did not consider the death toll credible. Many of the civilian deaths in the Syrian attacks have been the result of U.S. targeting refineries in territory held by the Islamic State, which are being run by civilians. The strikes are meant to be hurting the Islamic State's revenue streams, but are killing civilians and crippling the civilian infrastructure of the region. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. The BBC reports the NSA's mass surveillance program violates U.S. laws on free speech, alleges a lawsuit begun by the Wikimedia Foundation. The legal action has been filed against the spy agency and the U.S. Department of Justice. The legal action, co-signed by eight other organizations, seeks to end the NSA's large-scale surveillance efforts. The Wikimedia Foundation is the nonprofit group that oversees the running of the Wikipedia online encyclopedia. The foundation said it was taking action against the NSA's so-called upstream surveillance work, which targets communications with people not in the United States. They said that such spying violates U.S. laws on free speech and those that govern against unreasonable search and seizures. The scale of the monitoring carried out by the NSA has been revealed in the documents made public by whistleblower Edward Snowden over the last 2 years. Some of those papers show the NSA tapped the net's backbone network to siphon off data. The backbone is made up of high-speed cables that link big ISPs and key transit points on the net. Information in the Snowden papers revealed that Wikipedia has been explicitly targeted. In an accompanying editorial published in the New York Times, Wikipedia founder Jimmy Wells said he hoped the lawsuit would bring an end to the NSA's dragnet surveillance of internet traffic. For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. Reuters reports major world powers have begun talks about a UN Security Council resolution to unlift UN sanctions on Iran if a nuclear agreement is struck in Tehran, a step that could make it harder for the United States Congress to undo a deal. The talks between Britain, China, France, Russia, and the United States, the five permanent members of the Security Council, plus Germany and Iran, are taking place ahead of difficult negotiations that resume next week over constricting Iran's nuclear ability. Eight UN resolutions, four of them imposing sanctions, ban Iran from uranium enrichment and other sensitive atomic work, and bar it from buying and selling atomic technology and anything linked to ballistic missiles. There is also a UN arms embargo. Iran sees their removal as crucial, as UN measures are a legal basis for more stringent U.S. and European Union measures to be enforced. The U.S. and European Union often cite violations of the UN ban on enrichment and other sensitive nuclear work as justification for imposing additional penalties on Iran. U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry told Congress on Wednesday that an Iran nuclear deal would not be legally binding, meaning future U.S. presidents could decide not to implement it. But diplomatic officials say a Security Council resolution on a nuclear deal with Iran could be legally binding. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Caitlin Taggart was a beautiful, lively girl who loved laughing and playing outside, but all that changed at the age of 12. Caitlin slipped into a persistent vegetative state, confining her almost entirely to her bed and Facebook.
She doesn't even have basic motor functions anymore. We literally have to drag her to the car to drive her to school in the morning.
She's totally unresponsive when we talk to her. Her eyes just roll back in her head.
Caitlin, honey, it's your dad.
With no hope that their daughter would ever recover, the Taggarts decided to seek legal permission to end Caitlin's life.
It is the most difficult decision we've ever had to make, but we just keep reminding ourselves that the real Caitlin is already gone. That's just her body texting.
We give her one painless injection, and that's it. Her eyes may flutter a bit, or she may murmur, "Are you for real killing me right now?"
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. You are invited here to take control of the airwaves. 855-450-FREE is the number. That's 855-450-3733. And joining you in studio, you've got Ian here.
Danica.
And Daryl.
And said we were going to talk about the Liberty Dollar situation. Danica, are you familiar at all with the Liberty Dollar?
I remember hearing something about it, but I'm not very well known what it is. Could you explain that to me?
So it is. It was before Bitcoin. Probably the most popular alternative currency in the United States. I don't know if Bitcoin is the most popular alternative currency, but I would say it's probably safe to say it is. Bitcoin is probably used more often in the United States than the Liberty Dollar was, and it's probably possessed by more people than the Liberty Dollar. But the Liberty Dollar, I think, you know, back at its peak in the mid-aughts, so about a decade ago. I think that Bernard von Notthaus, the founder of the Liberty Dollar, claimed there were over 10 million of them in circulation, or at least $10 million worth, maybe not 10 million pieces. I don't recall the exact claim to fame, but it was a fairly large number. It was like, oh, that's a lot.
So what makes the Liberty Dollar, it's made out of silver and gold?
Yes. The most popular ones were made out of silver. So
okay.
Essentially it was an ounce of silver, and the idea behind the Liberty Dollar was that it existed not just to be an alternative currency, but to also be a tool to educate people.
Okay.
So the idea was that, and I was a Liberty Associate, as it was called. I was somebody who had purchased the Liberty Dollars at a slight discount, as they claimed, like there was a face value to it. And then, you know, they would sell it for less than that face value. But of course, the face value was higher than the price of an ounce of silver. And so it was being sold at more than the price of an ounce of silver,
and
obviously.
For anybody that might be confused, the Liberty Dollar that you're talking about was the private currency put out by Norfed.
Yes.
Not the old-timey silver dollar that had the Statue of Liberty on it.
Okay.
That is called a walking Liberty Dollar.
Yeah, thanks for clarifying that. This
NORFED
is
being the National Organization for the Repeal of the Federal Reserve and Internal Revenue Code.
Right, and that was what was created by Bernard von Notthaus, who's the creator of the Liberty Dollar. He actually worked with the Hawaiian Mint for a time as their, I think, monetary architect is the name that that he used. That's kind of his job title. So he would design the, sort of the way the piece looked, what sort of thing did it have on it, what information did it have on it. So he would design the dies that would then stamp these physical silver pieces.
Okay.
So they had silver pieces, and they had some gold pieces, and some platinum pieces.
And then later and
some copper. So they had different metals. And they also had what were called warehouse receipts. And the warehouse receipt essentially, you know, entitled you, the bearer of that receipt, if you had one or more of these things, to a certain amount of silver. So there were warehouse receipts that were 1/20th. They were worth 1/20th of an ounce of silver. So if you had, if you collected 20 of those, you would then be able to get an ounce of silver in return for it.
Okay.
The silver itself was held in a vault in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho.
Coeur d'Alene? Yes.
Okay. Coeur d'Alene, you're from that area.
She's
right?
Yes. Idahoan.
Boise, not Boise.
Right. You got it.
So what was it, Coeur d'Alene?
Coeur d'Alene.
Okay, so anyway, Coeur d'Alene, they had the Sunshine Mint, and that was where thousands of these ounces of silver were being held. So what ended up happening was the federal government came in 2007, I think it was November of 2007, they came to their offices, which were actually in Evansville, Indiana, They came to the offices and they raided the offices. And the office actually had some copper pieces there. It was actually, they were gearing up for the Ron Paul campaign in 2008. So Liberty Dollar or NorFed had actually created this Ron Paul piece or this Ron Paul dollar or whatever you want to call it.
They created a Ron Paul dollar?
Yeah.
Yes.
And they had it available in copper and silver.
Interesting. Okay.
And so they were gearing up for
and
the Ron Paul campaign.
And they made a few in gold as well.
They did. And so they sort of pre-sold these things. People would place their orders in advance, and then they'd get their order together, and then they'd send it to the mint and have it minted, and then they'd send it out to people. Right,
right on. That's pretty neat.
So they were actually getting ready to ship all of these Ron Paul pieces when the feds swept in, came in and raided the offices and stole all of their precious metals. They also went to the mint, in the Sunshine Mint, and they you know, the security agents let them in because it's the feds. And they stole all of the money that was in the vault, too.
They also seized computers and files and froze the Liberty Dollar bank accounts.
Yep. So basically just destroyed this business that had been for over a decade, had been supplying people with this alternative currency that essentially existed. And I didn't really expound on this. They existed for an educational purpose as well. So the idea behind using the Liberty Dollar was not just to get people to accept silver, but to help them understand why silver was better than the government's money. So, of course, you know, we would talk to people about fiat currency, which is what the government offers, these greenbacks that are backed by nothing, that at one time were actually backed by silver. So kind of the story that you could tell people was, oh, well, you know, you could show them like the idea of the silver certificate, which the U.S. government used to actually have.
Right. And you also made a point that coins were also held at how much they weighed, not just at face value.
Well, they did have a value on them, which was kind of one of the controversial things about the Liberty Dollar, is that there was a price that was set for that ounce. So, for instance, when back when I was involved, silver was like $9 per ounce was kind of the spot price.
Mm-hmm.
And but the Liberty Dollar would say $20 on it at that time. And so the idea behind putting
It was $10, and then once
it moved up,
once it moved above $10 for a while, then they put $20.
That's right.
Okay.
And then you could redeem the $10 1 ounce piece for the $20 1 ounce piece
if you paid a reminting fee, which I actually did at one point for some of mine, because I bought them at the $20 price and then they went up to a $50 price point as well. So there was this kind of this weird thing going on where it wasn't just an ounce of silver. It actually had this arbitrarily, you know, or apparently arbitrarily determined price put on it. And some people's argument would be, well, you know, that's not cool, passing off this $9 ounce of silver as though it's worth $20. That was kind of one of the big critiques about the Liberty Dollar. Now, the answer to that particular objection is that, well, it's only worth $20 if that's what you negotiate it to be worth, right? So if you get somebody to take an ounce of silver for $20 in return for something, then
it's worth $20.
It's worth $20 at that point. Again, it's still kind of a solid sounding argument to say, well, still, it's not really cool to go around acting as though silver is worth $20 if it's actually worth $9. But you could also argue that there was time and effort put into creating this what they call the silver liberty.
Sure.
It's not just your average ounce of silver. There's money behind marketing this, and it costs money to put it out there. And so the cost of this piece, you know, you could argue there's been value added to it above and beyond what the cost of the silver, like the raw cost of that silver, would be.
Right. And one thing that really got Bernard von Notthaus in trouble was using the word dollar. It's not, and there are some people that will probably want to argue with me on this and say, no, he was competing, so therefore that's why he went to jail. But it was really because he used the word dollar. And
at one point, he had "In God We Trust" on there as well.
Right. And then he changed that, I believe, to "Trust in God."
That's right.
He had it to be something to where an uneducated person could look at that and possibly get confused about whether or not this was something that had been put out by the U.S. Mint as like some new coin. Because it said dollar, it, you know, looked kind of like something that the U.S. Mint had previously put out.
Sure.
So because it looked too similar and it had the word dollar, that is what got him in trouble. And then there were people that were passing these off without explaining this is a private currency. They were just going to Walmart, hey, here's a $10 coin.
And trying to pass off just
and
like a
trying to pass it off to some unsuspecting cashier. And, you know, so there was the allegations of fraud, whether or not Bernard von Nothaus was involved in the fraudulent uses.
Well, I know Bernard von Nothaus always recommended people not use the word coin because apparently that's like a federal government only term. Like if you use the word coin, and then you're making it sound like it's
but
some
then you've
sort of
got
government
Bitcoin
currency.
And you know, while they can't necessarily attack Bitcoin as much as they're attacking dollar, it seems that there's a lot more fighting over this dollar than there has been Bitcoin. That's
over the Liberty
opinion.
Dollar? Well, yeah, I mean, you can't arrest anybody in charge of Bitcoin because no one's in charge.
Yeah, but good point.
They went after Bernard von Nothaus for sure, and he ended up getting convicted of counterfeiting. We'll tell you what the latest is in the case here in moments. 855 453. It's Free Talk Live.
Ooh, get the stinky dog away from me.
Petey stopped eating. All his hair fell out.
Mounds and mounds of fur. Our hairballs have hairballs.
Bad breath and bad gas.
Chew himself raw. Sticky, gooey, smelly.
She scratched incessantly.
At least $5,000 in vet bills.
And all it took was one container of Dinovite.
DINOVITE.com.
859-428-1000.
The omega-3 fatty acids.
Flaxseed, zinc, alfalfa.
The digestive enzymes that are cooked out of regular dog food.
Adding Dinovite to their diet has every single dog in my kennel looking better than they have ever looked.
The shedding has stopped and the itching has stopped.
Tons of energy, no more bad smell.
She has gotten this puppy look, her coat has sheen.
Everything we tried failed except the Dinovite.
My vet was completely blown away.
Dinovite's the bomb.
859-428-1000.
859-428-1000.
DINOVITE.com.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938, 877-357-9938.
Farmers keep livestock lean and healthy with a mineral-rich diet. Then, before market, they cut off minerals, leaving them to crave high-calorie grains. If weight control is this easy, why prescribe surgery for humans? Introducing Youngevity. You could avoid 900 diseases by getting 90 essential nutrients from Youngevity. Check out 90 for Life at tobeyoungagain.com or call 855-79-YOUNG. That's 855-79-YOUNG or tobeyoungagain.com. Youngevity. It's all about saving money, getting healthy, and creating wealth.
Free Talk Live.
Welcome to the world's most powerful spells by High Priestess Catherine Ulz. Now, this is kind of like a lot of those religions where you can just sort of just name yourself whatever you want to, right?
Right, exactly.
Super wizard.
Right there at the top. But 1 year unconditional money back guarantee. So like if your spell fails over the course of the year. Oh, the tumor came back.
Here are the terms. You must give the spell time to work. This time frame is 120 days from the date of purchase. That's
four months.
A request made.
I don't even want the lover back after 4 months.
You must allow for time for a full energy exchange. Sometimes our spells take time. Must not be that powerful. Why can't I upgrade? I mean, she charges $97. Oh, wait, no.
There's a sale that ends tonight at midnight.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
Shiny badges on your jacket, shiny badges.
This is Davi Barker from shinybadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at shinybadges.com, write worm.
forms in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
You can sign up to receive the latest about the Liberty Radio Network via our email updates at updates.lrn.fm. That's updates.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You may dial in toll-free and bring up anything that you want here at 855-450-FREE. Maybe you were a Liberty Dollar associate and you want to share your thoughts on sort of the rise and fall, ultimately at the hands of the government that happened to that organization. You're welcome to join us here. We've also got Skype. Our Skype username is lrn.fm, so feel free to connect in that way if you don't mind. It does tend to sound better when you do that. We're coming up on the Texas Bitcoin Conference, and we're just about 2 weeks away at this point. It's going to be March 28th and 29th at the Moody Theater in downtown Austin. Mark and myself will be there, and we'll be broadcasting Free Talk Live from the event. So I'm looking forward to that. There are going to be great speakers, as always. Of course, you can get a $25 discount off the $150 admission price. Now, $150 is actually pretty good for a weekend conference, but save $25 by using our discount code, which is FTL. So go to TexasBitcoinConference.com, use code FTL to get the deals. Plus, there's all kinds of great speakers like Anthony DiOrio, Robert Murphy, Jason King, David Johnston, George Gilder, Zimbala Nair, and more. Go to TexasBitcoinConference.com. Plus, when you use code FTL, another $25 off your admission fee will go to Sean's Outpost, a great Bitcoin-based charity that's helping the homeless in North Florida. So TexasBitcoinConference.com. We'll see you in downtown Austin, March 28th and 29th at the Moody Theater. TexasBitcoinConference.com, code FTL. Our toll-free number here is 855-450-FREE. We're talking about the Liberty Dollar, a very popular alternative currency that existed in the late 1990s. I don't know what year it started, maybe mid-90s. But mid to late 90s to basically 2007, where the owner and operator of the Liberty Dollar...
98 is when it started.
So they made it almost a decade before the federal government swooped in and stole almost all of their gold and silver, at least the gold and silver that was in the hands of the Liberty Dollar, right? So what they did was they shipped silver out to people. So you could physically get the physical one-ounce silver pieces that they called the Silver Liberties. And you can also get these warehouse receipts that represented silver that was in a warehouse, that was in a vault that you could, in theory, turn those receipts in and receive the actual silver for them. So the idea behind the warehouse receipts was that they don't weigh as much, right? So you can hold the...
Right, you can hang on to them until you want to have your actual physical piece.
And
with
those
you.
Were supposed to be 100% reserve?
What does that mean?
That for every warehouse receipt...
There was silver in the
there
vault.
Actually was silver.
Yes.
So there wasn't the fractional reserve.
Correct.
To where they would issue, you know, up to 10 times as many receipts.
Yes.
As what they actually had, gold or silver.
Not only that, but Liberty Dollar bragged that they audited. They had a third-party auditor come to the vault and check to make sure that, you know, what they actually had in the vault was what they said they had on the books, right? So they actually were audited, unlike the federal government, who, you know, there's been a call for years to so-called audit the Fed. You know, it's been very hard to just simply get
right.
the Fed to be audited.
Originally, like, you know, 7 years ago when the whole audit the Fed thing started, I was a big supporter of doing so. And now I'm a little more skeptical.
Why?
Because, one, it doesn't matter if the Fed is audited because the money, there's no claim that the money is backed by anything. Even if the Fed is audited, then there's no guarantee that anything nefarious will show up, which is what a lot of people think. Oh,
well,
you
the
know,
whole operation's
something
nefarious.
Nefarious is going to show up.
The whole thing's nefarious, like you were just pointing out. Fractional reserve banking, essentially giving out loans on money that doesn't even exist.
Right, but they're not even claiming that anything backs the dollar.
That's
the dollar
true.
Is backed
That's
by
true.
The full faith and credit of the United States government.
It's nothing.
Well, I have no faith in the United States government, so basically none of the paper dollars are worth anything.
They're only worth something because people think they are, right?
Right. Yeah. So,
and they're forced to take them. Legal tender.
Right. So I agree. The entire system is nefarious, but when I say, you know, nothing nefarious, or there's the possibility that nothing nefarious shows up on the books, I'm saying that, you know, there's no guarantee that, oh, see, they're, you know, extorting money out of their own business, or they're, you know, committing fraud in this way or that way, other than the fraud of, you know, just creating money out of thin air.
Yeah, I agree.
And, you know, even if something nefarious shows up, there's no guarantee that Congress would do anything
about
anyway.
It. Yep, exactly.
So at this point, I'm of the thinking it doesn't matter if the Fed ever gets audited because it probably won't make any difference anyway.
3,039 pounds of copper coins, 5,930 ounces of silver coins, less and not including approximately 1,574 ounces of contraband, as listed and described in the order of final disposal of contraband. Why they considered 1,500 of them contraband and the rest of them not, I don't know. 63 ounces of gold coins.
My guess is that the ones that had pictures of Ron Paul obviously were not anything put out ever by the U.S. government.
What was
the ones with pictures of the Statue of Liberty were the ones that really got Bernard von Notthaus in trouble.
Yeah, but I mean, okay, so we don't know what the breakdown is here, but this was coinage that was taken from the mint, right? And so this was the totality of their customers' coins. If people, and again, not using the word coin to make it sound like these are government things, the pieces.
Right.
This pieces. Is the totality of their customers'
silver
pieces.
Silver rounds.
And there's more here. 168,599 silver troy ounce coins. 147 gold troy ounce coins, et cetera, et cetera. Gold, silver, there's another seven. There's a lot of coins here. So it would seem like that, you know, if most of them did have like the Statue of Liberty on them. And so why they would only consider 1,500 of those ounces to be contraband is what doesn't make sense.
Like, right. And I would have to read that legal definition to be able to figure out, you know, based on my own interpretation, why some of it was and some wasn't. But it is very interesting, and I have the indictment where it, or not the actual indictment, but, you know, the put in plain English version of the indictment, where he was charged with one count of conspiracy to possess and sell coins in resemblance and similitude of coins of a denomination higher than 5 cents, and silver coins in resemblance of genuine coins of the United States in denominations of $5 or greater, and then it cites the U.S. code, one count of mail fraud, one count of selling and possessing with intent to defraud coins of resemblance and similitude of U.S. coins in denomination of 5 cents or greater, and one count of uttering, passing, and attempting to utter and pass silver coins
sounds
in resemblance
dirty.
Of genuine U.S. coins in denominations of $5 or greater.
Well, see, if he had started calling them silver rounds instead of naming them dollar, coin.
He didn't call them coins.
He didn't call them coins. He called them dollars, correct? Do you think he still would have gotten in trouble for the counterfeiting if he had still put the Statue of Liberty and we trust in God? Is that right that they put on
I believe it was We Trust in God
trust
or
in
Trust
God.
In God.
Yeah, Trust in God is what it was changed to. I think it was In
right,
God
was,
We Trust,
was,
and then he changed it.
Yeah, he changed it around.
But something else he did was, you know, there was a website on there. There was a phone number on there. I mean, anybody
not
who looked at
not the original iteration. That came a couple of years later.
Okay.
Well, I wonder, if he just kept calling himself around, do you think he would have gotten in as much trouble as he is now?
I don't
now?
Think so, and I'll explain why when we come back.
All right, more on the way here at 855-450-FREE, and we will give you the latest on what's actually happening, because he's been found guilty. We'll let you know the sentence in case you haven't heard that yet. And then what's going to happen to all of the silver and gold? 855-450-FREE.
By now, you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins, but did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoins by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit Escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
I've been told no in many different ways.
I give you an order and you're going to obey it.
We told you can go this way.
You can't do that and you have to leave here.
You cannot bring signs into the rally.
Walk with me.
Well, I'm comfortable here, actually.
Bureaucrats have a funny way of telling people no. That's the sound of the men
working on the chain. Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com. Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
This alert just came in. This special announcement is for business owners and leaders of organizations who've been waiting for the right time to build. General Steel has made it impossible to wait any longer with rock-bottom prices that could save you thousands. That's right, General Steel, America's leader in pre-engineered structures, is offering buildings at prices you will never see again. Don't miss these prices. A 50 by 100 for under $30,000. You heard right. That's 5,000 square feet under $30,000. Manufacturers, if you need a larger building, try a 100 by 100 commercial building for $129,000. You can't afford to rent with these prices. Imagine a 70 by 100 foot church building for under $69,000. With the economy improving and interest rates still at historic lows, you can't afford to wait.
Call 800-917-8251. 800-917-8251. 800-917-8251.
What's up next? Visit the Liberty Radio Network program guide to find out at shows.lrn.fm. That's shows.lrn.fm.
Welcome back to Free Talk Live. You can dial toll-free here and bring up what you want at 855-450-FREE. You can also join us via Skype. Skype username here is lrn.fm, so feel free to reach out in that way if you like. That's again username lrn.fm. ExpressCoin, the best choice for getting your cryptocurrencies: Bitcoin, Litecoin, Dogecoin. It's fast, safe, easy, and inexpensive, and they are a licensed money services business, so hopefully that means the government won't raid them.
As long as they don't say dollar coin.
Since they're jumping through the government's hoops, you can get your cryptocurrencies with money order, check, or wire transfer. Start up over at ExpressCoin.com. Whether you're in the U.S. or Canada, ExpressCoin.com can help you. And you can even do it from your smartphone with their app over at ExpressCoin.com. Use coupon code FTL. you'll get up to $40 worth of the cryptocurrency of your choice with no fee at all at expresscoin.com. Again, coupon code FTL. Daryl, you were going to explain something to Danica, who's totally new to the idea of the Liberty Dollar, which is this alternative currency created by an organization called NorFed, which was ultimately raided by the feds in 2007.
Right. So Danica had asked the question, and correct me if I'm misrepresenting your question. Had Bernard von Nothaus and NorFed not put the word dollar on their medallions, would they have still gotten in trouble?
Correct.
And I tend to think that no, they would not. And the reason I say that is based on my knowledge of entities that opened up about the time that Liberty Dollar was shut down, where basically they learned from some of the mistakes that were made by the Liberty Dollar people. And the American Open Currency Standard is one of those. And there was a blog post in 2009 by Rob Gray, the director of AOCS, and he explains some of the differences between Liberty Dollar and AOCS. He says AOCS approved medallions are not dollars. Though many struggle to actually define a dollar, the federal government likes to think that they own the word. Mm. Liberty dollars were denominated in dollars, and as such were confused from time to time by those unfamiliar with the alternative currency system. After all, Liberty dollars are not issued by the Federal Reserve. AOCS-approved medallions have no specific brand or denomination, so right. They make sure that they do not put the word dollar
or the dollar sign. Or the
well, there's one that has something that is similar to a dollar sign.
Oh.
But it's so large to where, you know, it's obvious that that's not what it is.
Okay.
And then there's a word, I believe it's the Danconia copper round, and very large words, it says Danconia copper.
Yep.
So it's very obvious that this is not a dollar coin and that that's not supposed to be a dollar sign. The AOCS medallions are unique. Part of the confusion, Rob Gray writes, may have been caused by the fact that Liberty dollars look suspiciously a lot like coins issued at one time or another by a federal government. Was the Liberty dollar designed to be easily mistaken? Question mark. Each AOCS-approved medallion is designed specifically to avoid any confusion with existing coinage. And finally, he writes...
Well, before you go on, I mean... I think there's nothing wrong with AOCS. It's a great standard, and everything I've seen that has the AOCS stamp on it has been very, very beautiful and very attractive. The idea behind the Liberty Dollar was to put the dollar sign on it so as to kind of bridge the gap from the world of the U.S. currency to the idea of just using ounces or half ounces or quarter ounces of silver. Now, whether or not Bernard von Nothaus' secret intention was to make it so similar to the U.S. dollar or the U.S. government's currency that it could be used in sort of a not so honest fashion, I guess. I'm not going to speculate on that.
Slowly sneaking it into the system.
But you have to admit that there were people that were just sneaking it in and giving the money to people without telling them.
Yeah.
You know, this is an alternative currency. Here's information. Would you be willing to accept this coin?
So it's not quite the same as when someone slips in a Canadian dime for an American dime.
Right, like that's totally by accident because half the people that do that don't even pay attention
right,
that it's
yeah,
a Canadian
they don't pay attention
dime.
To it.
Well, I don't think there's anything necessarily wrong with just giving somebody this silver piece and trying to pay for something with it. I mean, you don't have every opportunity to go on a lecture tour when you're checking out at Office Depot, you know, and I've actually done that. I've taken these things to different places and I have spent them without necessarily giving a treatise on sound money because you don't have time, especially if there's people behind you in line. Then you're rude if you're like, whoa, hold on, let me explain this to you.
Let me talk to you about the Liberty Dollar.
And that's the final point that Rob Gray makes in his post. Is that AOCS medallions do not require you to do the drop. With the Liberty Dollar model, supporters were urged to spend Liberty Dollars nearly anywhere with, quote, a 90% acceptance rate, end quote. This was done not necessarily through education, but instead by dropping a heavy ounce of silver in a proprietor's hand and offering little in the way of disclosure that a Liberty dollar and any other limited use currency, for that matter, has advantages and drawbacks and can only be voluntarily exchanged when both parties are aware of the truth. On the other hand, AOCS-approved medallions can be traded one-to-one for credit in any existing barter group, of which there are hundreds of thousands of participating merchants across the U.S.
But you can't go into an average location where nobody really knows what silver is or what an ounce of silver is worth or anything like that and actually spend an AOCS silver ounce, whereas you could do that with a Liberty dollar. You could take it to locations. I did it at Office Max more than once, and I did it at an ice cream store previously.
Right, but the question is, did Office Max or the ice cream store know
that? It doesn't matter. Buyer beware. So if they wanted to ask questions, then certainly I would answer those questions, and I wouldn't, you know, stray away from what the truth was. I mean, obviously, I'd like to talk to somebody about sound currency, but if there's a line behind me and people need to keep moving, I'm just going to keep moving on. And the people suspect that the cashiers would end up buying them at the end of the night or something like that. Like take it out of their drawer, put in their own currency to replace it, and then take it home. Because obviously, once you get to the bank, it's going to end there, right? So if, for instance, it goes into the cash register and the cashier doesn't buy it for themselves at the end of the day, it's going to get to the back office and somebody counting that's going to be like, what's this? And they're going to maybe try to take it to the bank thinking it's real. And at some point, it's going to get kicked back. And what I would do, Daryl, was I would leave a business card as well. So the person could get in touch with me and I would be willing to come and buy it back also from the person. So it wasn't like.
But how many other people were willing to do
that? I don't
know.
It's none of my business. I mean, I have no clue. And really, who cares? I mean, if you were to take a lump of coal and drop it into somebody's hand and say, hey, I'd like to pay with this, and then they go ahead and they say, okay, I really need some coal, and then they give you some money back or something like that, then, you know, that's a legitimate transaction. Just because it's not legal tender
doesn't mean it's... Right, but if you put a dollar sign on a lump of coal, it doesn't make it a dollar. You do acknowledge that, right?
Yeah. No, I understand what you're saying.
Right, so... The point that is being made is that people were using these without explaining to the person they were giving it to this is not a dollar.
No, it's like $20 was what they were saying. They would drop this thing in somebody's hand and say...
I'm using the term dollar in the colloquial term of a dollar bill.
Right, that this is not U.S. currency.
This
is
not U.S. currency.
Right.
People were not saying that every time it was being used. Mm-hmm. That's where the charge of fraud came in.
Yeah. I don't agree that's fraud.
I'm not going to say that it necessarily is fraud, but based on the current wording of U.S. law... Yeah. It falls under the U.S. law definition of fraud.
It would only
now,
be
if you want to have a discussion about whether or not there should be legal tender, that's another topic.
It's only fraud if you say something about it being legal tender, or if you
say this is $20 and it's not.
Well, I don't think you would say that it was $20. I think you would say that it was a $20 piece or something like that.
Well, they were selling it for $20.
Live. There's more coming up here in moments.
Hey, it's Mark of Free Talk Live, and I want to tell you about a new way to be prepared for emergencies. Not just big emergencies, but little ones too. It's a source of backup power, so small that I can put it in my pocket or the glove box of my car, but it's so powerful that it can actually jumpstart a bus if I need it to. Sounds crazy, but it's not. I'm talking about a breakthrough in portable power technology called the Pocket Power Plus. If you get stranded in an airport, in your car, or you just want to go off the grid for a while, the Pocket Power Plus becomes your own personal mini power plant. Run pretty much any kind of electronic device for hours, even days if you need to. The Pocket Power Plus can also deliver an enormous supply of on-demand power that can jumpstart almost any vehicle, even the coldest winter days. Comes with free jumper cables and an accessory pack. Best part, my listeners can now get Pocket Power Plus for half price by going to PocketPowerPlus9.com. That's PocketPowerPlus9.com. Use coupon code FTL to save even more. Go to PocketPowerPlus9.com, PocketPowerPlus9.com, coupon code FTL.
So who else will you meet at the Get Prepared Expo? For starters, from Republic Broadcasting, John Moore and John Statmiller. From GCN, Aaron and Brad Dakins, Joyce Riley, and me, Vincent Finelli. Joining us are the instructors whom you've learned to trust. Surgeon of the Year, Dr. Norman Shuley. Engineer, Matt Stein. The real Fox Mulder of the X-Files, Dr. Richard Allen Miller. Author and analyst, Captain John Reagan. Your counterterrorist from Central America, Mike Ma. Dental center owner and my dentist, Dr. Howard Shane. Radiation instructor, Craig Douglas. Author and survivalist, Rich Sheban. Author, Judy Dollarhite. Cancer center owner from Mexico, Dr. Patrick Vickers. Bug out expert and pilot, Captain Bill Sermo. Beekeeper, Jeff Maddox. Seedsman, Mike Knox. Author, Gayla Pruitt. Author, Harry Cooper. Food expert, Joe Acapinti. And Bill Whaley, the junk man. March 27, 28, and 29. GetPreparedExpo.com, the largest preparedness and survival expo in the USA.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace Love Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at lrn.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at lrn.fm. That's lrn.fm.
Do you drink coffee? Was the last cup of coffee you had really good? Free Talk Live has teamed up with BuzzBox to bring you the best of the best coffee. Shade grown, organic, top 1% grade Arabica. But what's different is for every 10 people that get their coffee through coffee.freetalklive.com, we can give another microloan through Kiva. Get a free pound to try it out. A free pound of the best coffee. Help others one cup at a time. coffee.freetalklive.com.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. You can dial toll-free, share your thoughts here, especially if you've had some encounters with the Liberty Dollar. Our toll-free number here is 855-450-FREE, 855-450-3733. And there's more to say about it because we actually haven't even gotten to the real point of the discussion, which is what's the latest in the case. But, you know, you've got to give people background and an understanding on what this thing was, this independently produced silver round and also a set of warehouse receipts. There were some gold rounds and some platinums as well in there.
And copper.
And copper, ultimately towards the very end. And the federal government stole it all in a raid in 2007 at their Evansville offices.
All of what was in the offices. They did not steal what was in the possession of private
people.
Individuals.
That's correct. So there were thousands of Liberty Dollars they alleged millions of dollars worth of them in circulation. So hundreds of thousands presumably were out there amongst the population. How much of them were circulating at any moment in time is another question. I imagine they were very, very beautiful pieces. They were likely sitting in people's vaults and drawers and, you know, places that were not circulating.
So when you were using the Liberty Dollar, were you ever trying to pass off the warehouse receipts as dollars?
Good question. I don't recall doing that. I don't think so, because they were a little more questionable, right? Like, they were obviously something that was unusual and would have required a lot more explaining than to just hand somebody a piece of silver. But we can talk more about that here in a moment. We've got Ashley on the line in Keene. Ashley, you're on Free Talk Live.
So I was wondering.
Hello.
If I got a job with you guys, would you pay me in Liberty dollars?
Well, I would presume that we have Liberty dollars in which to pay you, but also presumes we have a job available, which we really don't, unfortunately. Anything else you want to share tonight, Ashley?
Yeah, I was wondering, like, can I get a job, like, you know, like sucking dick over
there?
Oh,
you can't say that on the radio. The toll-free number here is 855-450-FREE. Yeah, we are actually doing a radio show, so if you say things like
that's not very
sexual,
nice of him.
In a very sexual manner, we kind of have to let that go.
Yeah.
So
and the seven words, you can't say those.
Yep. So toll-free number, 855-450-FREE. So anyway, you were going on a line of questioning there, Daryl, about the Liberty Dollar.
Yeah, so I had asked if you ever tried using the warehouse receipts, and you said that not that you recall, because that would require, quote-unquote, a little more explaining.
Yeah.
So the reason I had asked that was because you said, well, basically, buyer beware if I give you something and say that it's $20 and it turns out to be, you know, like a large chunk of plastic.
Well, you wouldn't say that it's $20. You know, the idea behind doing the drop was the merchant would say...
Well, on the back of that, it says $20.
Yeah, that's right. So the merchant would say, well, that's, you know, $18.99. And then you'd drop the silver. You'd say something like, do you accept silver? And then the merchant would look at that and they'd notice, well, this feels like it's real money. And they might take it. They might not. They might ask questions. They might not.
Okay, but ultimately, like, you know, it was not necessarily a voluntary transaction every time with 100% consent of the person receiving the silver.
Of course it was a voluntary transaction with 100% consent. Whether or not they were 100% aware of exactly what it was they were accepting.
Right, so that's not 100% consent.
Yes, it is consent. Whether or not the buyer is 100% informed on the exact details of the product that they're taking. Most people who purchase a product from Walmart don't know all the details about it. You don't know how many pieces are in the Lego box unless you actually looked and acquired that information. And all you had to do to look, you know, acquire information was look at this thing. It said 1 ounce of 0.999 fine silver on it. It did not hide what it was. So the person was very well aware that they were looking at us and what it was an ounce of silver.
I imagine when you were also using the Liberty Dollar that you didn't have as big of a market as you do right now with Bitcoin, with agorist marketplaces or businesses that do take Bitcoin.
Yeah. Well, there were some people who you knew accepted Liberty Dollar, like okay. They were on a list of businesses that were known.
Okay, so there
quantities,
was a little bit something like that.
But there
that.
Weren't that many of them.
Sure.
Very, very few.
Right. So the reason that I'm asking is because I'm curious, if you put $3 worth of Bitcoin on a paper wallet and wrote $3 on it, mm-hmm. and you went and tried to spend it at, you know, one of the local stores here in Keene, would you expect them to accept it the way you expected people to take your piece of silver?
Oh, I never expected people to take the silver. It was just always nice when they did.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, why would you expect someone to take something that is unusual?
Because people were told, like, you can spend this, 90% of places in the country will take this.
I've never heard that claim. I don't remember hearing that claim at all. I mean, I was, like I said, I was a Liberty associate, and I've never heard that claim. That sounds ridiculous. No
I remember
way,
hearing that claim
no
several
way.
Times.
Well, it's like you said, if you slip it in, don't say anything, they're probably not going to notice it.
Oh, so. They're going to notice. No, the idea is these are very noticeable. They're beautiful, polished silver pieces. They look nothing like U.S. currency unless it's some sort of silver piece made by the U.S. Mint. They don't look like a quarter. They don't look like a dime. I mean, those things are made out of crap can metal. I don't even know what metals go into those products. But the idea behind doing the drop, as it was called, sort of like a business term for the Liberty Dollar, was that this is a heavy 1 ounce piece. You don't even if you're paying with multiple quarters, it doesn't feel like an ounce of weight. It has weight to it. It's real. It feels like it's real money. And that was the idea, is it was real money, unlike the government's money system, and people were supposed to stop and take note. And it happened. You know, you gave this person this silver piece, and they were shocked by it, like, oh wow, it's shiny, it's pretty. And it definitely was an attractive piece. So they would want to take this thing. A lot of people would. Not everybody. You know, some people would say, hey, boss, can we take this ounce of silver? And sometimes the answer was yes, sometimes it was no. So it wasn't like these people were completely uninformed. The ounce itself said on there that it was an ounce. It had a what was essentially an MSRP, the price point, the manufacturer suggested retail price, written on it. And it was a completely voluntary transaction. And I can understand why the AOCS would be railing against the Liberty Dollar, because essentially they're their competition. I mean, Liberty Dollar was very, very successful, and AOCS is a currency standard, and they have their standards for a reason, and there's good reasons for them. And there was an argument that the Liberty Dollar shouldn't have had the dollar sign on it, and that it shouldn't have had, you know, a $20 denomination written on there. There are a couple of different arguments. One of them was that, well, it sucks when the price goes up because then, you know, you have to remint these things,
right,
which is a costly process. Or if the price goes down, you'd then have to remint downwards as well if you wanted to kind of keep the price up with the actual average silver price, which, you know, again, is costly because you're paying more money into all. If you want to, you have to literally send your silver into the mint. They melt them down and then they remint them. And it was like, I remember when I did it, it was like $3 per piece. So it was pretty rough.
Wow.
To actually
plus
do that.
Plus the shipping cost.
Right. Uh-huh. And plus you're losing your silver, right, for a period of time while that happens. So I didn't really like that feature about it, but I understood why it existed. And the reason why it was the reason why it existed, unless you believe it was for fraudulent purposes, is to sort of bridge the gap from the money system that we have with the fiat currency.
I'm not saying that I think that, yeah, you know, the intent behind Liberty Dollar was fraud.
Okay.
I'm just saying there was some fraud in the use of Liberty
Dollar. I can see how someone could use it in a fraudulent purpose, but the official, you know, story from the Liberty Dollar, with the way they would recommend you use it, was not, I did not think in any way fraudulent. I certainly wouldn't have been involved. I did not want to be involved in something that was fraudulent.
And I also recall hearing that Walmart was the largest acceptor of Liberty Dollars.
Never had that happen. I don't know
because
if
because people would just go to Walmart and say, here's a $10 coin.
Hmm.
Even whether or not that's what Liberty Dollar corporate said to do,
right. Yeah, you're not,
that's what
to do that.
Some people were doing.
Right. Well, I mean, you can't control everybody, right? I mean, you put something out there and people are going to do what they're going to do. You never know what things folks will come up with. And certainly there are scam artists out there. But the way it was marketed, the way that it was recommended to use, it was always, I thought, on the up and up. So
for the people in the know, but again, like, you know, once, well, it goes third hand to where somebody has it and they've never met anybody that was a Liberty associate, have no clue.
Buyer beware. There's a website right on there. There's a phone number on there. I mean, anybody that wanted to learn about this, it was not hidden. They could Google it or whatever. There's plenty of information out there about this thing. So
there's information about a lot of things, but most people don't want to learn about things.
Bernard von Nothaus was essentially charged with counterfeiting. There were a few other charges that you mentioned there, but that was the gist of it. He ultimately was found guilty, sentenced to 3 years of probation. Now, he was facing 20-plus years in federal prison for this. The judge did send him sentence him to 3 years of probation. And by the way, he waited, I think, about 3 to 4 years to actually get the sentence.
Maybe yes, several years.
It was so.
Yeah, that's because they started the raid in 2007.
Right, and then he was found guilty 2010 or something like that, or 2011.
Yeah, 8 years from when it first happened.
So we'll tell you what has happened here in a moment with the silver itself, because the government still got that. Well, what are they going to do with it? We'll tell you more coming up on Free Talk Live.
On your jacket, shiny badges.
Did we have some packet ball?
That was the
ISDN.
This
is Davi Barker from shinybadges.com, and I just want to personally apologize for airing a jingle week after week, month after month, that turned out to be such an infectious brain worm. So to make it up to you, I'm offering a free gift. The next time you make a purchase at shinybadges.com,
probably actually
write
try to
worms in the transaction comments, and I'll send you something weird.
In a trial by jury, the primary function of a juror is not to dispense punishment to the accused. It is to protect your fellow citizens from being unjustly deprived of their life, liberty, or property. As a juror, you can say no to unjust laws and prevent government abuses of power by refusing to convict. Legislative, executive, judicial. The fourth branch of government is we the people. Find out more from the Fully Informed Jury Association at fija.org.
Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross may be spending the rest of his life in prison. His family is planning to appeal his conviction, but they need your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Ross needs your help now more than ever. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org. Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number three is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
This is the Liberty Beat, your daily source for Liberty news and activist updates, online at thelibertybeat.com. I'm Brian Hagan with your Liberty Beat for Friday, March 13th, 2015. Gold opened today at $1,156, up $2. Silver opened at $15.54, down 5 cents. And Bitcoin is trading around $292.58. Today's Bitcoin price is brought to you by ExpressCoin, the fastest, most reliable way to buy Bitcoin. Buy Bitcoin today at ExpressCoin.com. In the news, a post office in Colorado has been found using hidden cameras to record the license plates and facial features of customers leaving. Fox 31 Denver investigative reporter Chris Halsney confirmed that hidden cameras and recorders owned and operated by the United States Postal Inspection Service were being used in Golden, Colorado, outside of Denver. The camera was found hidden inside a utilities box around Thanksgiving 2014. A spokesperson for Postal Inspection Service declined to confirm or deny whether the camera was collecting data for specific cases. After the camera was initially reported, it was removed. A new bill that would restrict the ability to film the police and create a dangerous definition of media has been introduced to the Texas House of Representatives. Texas House Bill 2918 would require individuals filming or recording the police to be at least 25 feet away, and those who are open carrying would need to be more than 100 feet away. The bill also sets the standard for filming police to only radio or TV media outlets that hold a license that has been issued by the Federal Communications Commission. A new Gallup poll highlights Americans' growing discontent with the United States government. A poll conducted from March 5th through the 8th asked 1,025 American adults what the biggest problems Americans currently are facing. 18% of those polled said the government was the most important problem. 11% listed the economy, while 10% said jobs were the biggest issue. 31% of Americans said they were satisfied with the state of the country. The Liberty Beat is sponsored by CoinArch, offering innovative trading solutions for Bitcoin. Do more than just buy and sell Bitcoin. Use long and short positions to profit in rising and falling markets and boost your returns through leverage. Visit CoinArch.com and sign up using coupon code MAX to get free brokerage for the first 7 days. Looking to promote your business or cause to tens of thousands of loyal listeners? Well, for a limited time only, the Liberty Beat is offering you the chance to say big while spreading your message. It's simple. Just sign up for 3 months of advertising and get your fourth month free. Don't miss out on this unique opportunity. Just visit thelibertybeat.com/advertise and use coupon code GCN in the Describe Your Company section. This is the Liberty Beat for Friday, March 13th, 2015. Make sure you check out the website at thelibertybeat.com. Texas State Representative David Simpson has introduced a new bill that would require Texas water supply systems to display information related to water fluoridation on their websites. Texas House Bill 1581 would require the amount of fluoride, the name of the company supplying it, the combined amount of fluoride in the drinking water from all sources, the annual cost of adding fluoride to the drinking water distributed by the system, and more. If passed by a vote of two-thirds of all the members, the bill goes in effect immediately. If the vote passes with less than two-thirds, it will go into effect September 1st, 2015. Two new parents are in the midst of a national tour promoting the use of Bitcoin and highlighting their experience raising a child with no birth certificate or Social Security card for the Undocumented Human Tour. Alma Summer and Brian Stith are traveling with baby Neo, who was born October 17, 2014, without a birth certificate or Social Security number. The family is traveling from Southern California to the Bitcoin Summit in Arizona and the Texas Bitcoin Conference in Austin. They're also working on connecting the decentralized network of individuals who do not submit their children to government documents for proof of birthday and location of birth. You can follow their adventures on their blog online at undocumentedhuman.com. The Liberty Beat is sponsored by Midas Resources Incorporated, helping clients convert their paper 401ks and IRAs to solid gold and silver. Get their 10 Reasons book free by calling 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237. Support also comes from the Texas Bitcoin Conference. Hear from speakers like Charlie Schrem, Dr. Robert Murphy, Vitalik Buterin, and Catherine Bleich. March 28th and 29th at ACL Live at the Moody Theater. Tickets on sale now at TexasBitcoinConference.com. Use coupon code LibertyBeat for $25 off your ticket. That's coupon code LibertyBeat. This is the Liberty Beat for Friday, March 13th, 2015. I'm Brian Hagan, reporting. Reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
A hot new murder craze sweeps Chicago. Things that shouldn't be said in modern society are said 1,400 times at the RNC, and a brave woman enters a restaurant without first looking it up online. This is the Onion Week in Review. The World Wildlife Fund quickly backtracked Thursday from a recently released press statement saying panda ears are, quote, absolutely delicious. Organization officials noted that while panda ears do taste amazing, braised, steamed, fried, or cooked in an omelet, they should not have announced it publicly, nor should they have ever eaten any part of a cheetah, giraffe, or Bengal tiger, no matter how good they may be. According to company sources, the Netflix board of directors held a tense series of meetings earlier this morning to decide whether the fantasy comedy Michael is stream-worthy. The board reportedly sat through its mandatory two back-to-back screenings of the 1996 film starring John Travolta as an angel visiting Earth, all while passionately arguing over the film's story, acting, and level of enjoyment upon subsequent viewings to determine if the movie should be available through its instant viewing program.
This is the Onion News Network.
Free Talk Live, you can join us here on the radio waves. 855-450-FREE is the number. It's 855-450-3733. We've been talking about the Liberty Dollar. Earlier tonight, the NSA being sued by the Wikimedia Foundation. Of course, you can bring up whatever is on your mind, and our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Liberty Dollar, for those of you who don't know, was, I guess, an alternative currency that gained some level of notoriety in between 1998 and 2007.
Notoriety to catch the attention of the feds.
Yes, and get criminal charges thrown against the operator, Bernard von Notthaus, who many years ago actually spoke at the Liberty Forum, which is an event that we actually just finished up with last weekend here in New Hampshire. He was one of the keynote speakers at either the first or the second Liberty Forum. I think it might have been the first one.
Oh, that's cool.
It must have been the first one because he hadn't been raided at that point, I don't think. Well, anyway, so they went after him. They confiscated thousands of ounces of silver, hundreds of thousands of ounces of silver from their vaults in Coeur d'Alene.
I think I'm going to have to try and say that a few more times to get it stuck in your head.
I was saying Coeur d'Alene, and so you're saying it's Coeur d'Alene.
Coeur d'Alene, yeah.
Coeur d'Alene. So anyway, they went and they took all that silver and gold and then ultimately convicted him with a jury, even though these silver pieces, to me, did not resemble U.S. currency, considering they had a phone number and a website printed on them. I didn't think it looked at all like U.S. currency, but nonetheless, the jury seemed to think so, and he was sentenced to 3 years probation. So I want to get back to a little more of the story here, because the update is, what is going to happen to the hundreds of thousands of ounces of silver that the government now has? Many people have these warehouse receipts issued by the Liberty Dollar folks that entitle them to collect that silver, and so the warehouse receipts were essentially made valueless by the raid, technically, because you can't turn them in for the silver. But the interesting thing is, if you've got one of those warehouse receipts and you put it on eBay, you'll actually get more than an ounce's worth of silver dollars.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
They become collector's items, essentially.
I wonder if they're going to auction off like they did the Silk Road's bitcoins.
I don't know what they do with it eventually, but what's happening right now, Danica, is there's been an order issued from the judge, and the order essentially says that if this is your money, if you have some of these dollars that you have the warehouse receipts for, then you can file with the court some kind of a petition to try to get them back.
Interesting.
Now, you have to. It's interesting, and Bernard von Notthaus he's the creator of the Liberty Dollar. He's advocating that people go after their coinage here to try to get the pieces back from the federal government. But I have some questions about this. First of all, in order to file, you do have to do it within 30 days. It was a fairly short window. You have to file, you know, two copies of it. You have to sign it under the penalty of perjury. It has to be notarized. And then once it's accepted by the court, you know, you could then be sent depositions or forced to go to a deposition. You could then be sent interrogatory. So essentially you're opening a civil case with the court by doing this. And they could also subpoena you as well. So
it sounds as though like this is some weird sort of asset forfeiture stuff to where things have been seized. And you are now basically saying, this is my property, stop the proceedings, because I want to get my property back.
Correct.
And that's probably going to wind up costing thousands of dollars.
That's what I find myself
wondering. In order to wind up getting your, 5 ounces of silver?
Or whatever. I mean, I'm sure there's some people with fairly large deposits with the Liberty Dollar folks, but there probably aren't very many of them. But that really brings up a few questions here, right? Because, first of all, what will it cost? I mean, it's not going to be as simple. It's the court system. So as much as it would be nice as if it were as simple as, oh, you just send this these two forms in and then they'll send you your silver. No.
Yeah, it's not your $5 cashback rebate from AutoZone.
I couldn't hear you, Danica. What was that?
I was just making a joke that I was just like, yeah, you'll get it back after sending these two forms after 30 days.
No, it's going to be much more than that because then they might give you interrogatories, which are questions that you have to answer under the penalty of perjury.
Yep.
They may ask you, when did you buy these coins? How did you acquire them? You have to have this information if you're going to go through this process, which ultimately they may still deny you at the end of all of it. If they haven't determined to their satisfaction that these are yours, then they're definitely not going to give them back to you. But my question is, and I actually sent an email to Bernard von Nothaus about this, wondering if he had actually considered these things. The points I made in my email are, one, what if this process is being used to collect evidence against Liberty Dollar Associates with the purposes of bringing criminal charges for conspiracy to counterfeit against them? What if they're using this, they're hanging this out there like a honeypot, so to speak, or you know, some bait, to say, well, we don't know who has these coins, or we don't know who has these warehouse receipts that are a representative of the silver. So we can find out who owns them by just asking them to send us their contact information. And so then all these poor people who just want to get their silver back are going to send their contact information to the feds, hoping they can get their hands on the money that they believe is rightfully theirs. And then they're just essentially handing over sworn affidavits. Well, or, you know, if they're handing over a sworn statement saying that this is my product. And could that result, if this is considered contraband, and you, Daryl, were suggesting that maybe it isn't, but there was a press release by the U.S. Marshals back in the day when this whole arrest thing happened suggesting that this was contraband. And so, you know, how loosely that definition will be utilized when it comes to bringing criminal charges against people, I imagine they will be very loose and fast with that, if that's their intention here. The other question was, so as I pointed out, right now they don't know who has these receipts, and it would take them a lot of investigative work to find that out. But if you come to them and give them the information they're seeking, they might come back at you with criminal charges rather than giving you the silver back.
Right, for conspiracy. I think you're more likely to wind up getting a conspiracy charge than a possession of contraband. Because nothing that I have seen so far says that mere possession of a Liberty Dollar is illegal. I know I've heard a bunch of people say that, but I have yet to see anything issued stating such a thing.
Let's go to Taran in North Carolina, or Taran, rather. Taran, you're on Free Talk Live.
Hey, Taran, how are you guys?
Well, they spelled it differently than you do. So, I'm good. Go ahead.
We've got somebody calling from Tehran.
Hey, Daryl. Hey, Danica.
What's up, Taran?
I used to be a Liberty associate way back in the day, like in 2000. And the way we did it back then is, you know, I think it was a lot more on the level. Like Daryl was saying, you know, there was a time where they were encouraging people to drop. But I remember in my practice, we had a when people made change, you would offer them, do you want silver? You want greenbacks? And then you just hand them the silver. And I also had a little pamphlet giving more information. And it just kept, I never had one problem with it. Like, nobody was like, oh, you scammed me. You know, I mean, you gave them the information when you used it.
I feel like maybe someone called me for a buyback one time. I'm not even really sure about that. But yeah, most people were pretty open-minded.
I could see if you were trying to pass it off shady, you know, that could be a problem. My issue, though, is, you know, right before they got raided, I bought a bunch of coppers for the Ron Paul thing, you know, and I actually got really lucky that I had a couple get out. I had a platinum piece get out like 2 days before they got busted.
Oh, wow.
And, yeah, actually, Mark has it, I think. I think I sold it to I think you guys
so
have
are you
right?
going to go for so, this? Are you going to give the feds your information?
I don't think so. I don't think it's worth it for coppers, man. I really feel like you're just handing yourself over. And, you know, it's been 8 years now, so I don't care about them. Like,
right, it's gone. I mean, this is stolen money at this point. If you could get it back, it'd be nice. But, I mean, what kind of hoops are they going to make you jump through? I mean, as I pointed out here in my email to Bernard, who he hasn't responded yet, by the way, I said, number two, it appears that from the order, the petition can at least lead to depositions, interrogatories, and even being subpoenaed. It seems likely they'll require claimants to show up to court for a hearing, where if things go well, they'll get the product back. That's the best case scenario from what I can tell. This may be convenient for anyone in Asheville, North Carolina, but outside of the immediate area, or Evansville, or wherever the heck this happened, many of us would have to spend more on travel than the Liberty dollars themselves would be worth.
And how many people actually have receipts of purchases that
from
they made
a decade
7 years ago?
Maybe even longer than that.
I don't have a warehouse receipt. I just bought the thing on my credit card, and man, I don't know how to get my records 8 years from ago. You know, from my
good luck with
card.
That.
Taryn, thanks for your call tonight, man. I appreciate it. Yeah, toll free number 855-450-FREE. You may bring up whatever's on your mind. Maybe you were a Liberty associate. You've got some comments on being involved with the Liberty dollar. And also, are you going to go for the reclaiming of the silver? It's Free Talk Live.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. It's physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it, but here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101reasonsfilm.com. 101reasonsfilm.com.
Making the right decisions is a challenge to investors. Are we going to see economic growth slide into a recession or, at worst, depression? Hi, Ted Anderson from Midas Resources. We all know when a company acts irresponsibly, divesting ourselves in a move towards safety is prudent. When the market becomes volatile, U.S. treasuries are a safe haven. But what do you do when the U.S. government overextends itself and spends beyond its means? Many investors are turning toward gold as a common-sense alternative to traditional paper investments. Midas Resources has put together a powerful book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, discussing costs, benefits, risks, featuring full-color illustrations, weights, and measures. The book is free and can be yours by calling 800-686-2237. Paper investments are dwarfed by gold's 6,000-year history. Discover how gold may be right for you and your IRA by calling 800-686-2237. Whether buying or it's time for you to sell, the book is free. Call 800-686-2237.
On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on joined the Free State Project and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. You can help by joining the AMP program for just $5 a month at amp.freetalklive.com and getting perks. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
Did you know that FreeAid is a mutual aid, educational, and networking organization? At FreeAid, we support volunteers who provide first aid. We do outreach to the public about health and safety, and we bring together medically skilled freedom lovers. FreeAid is made possible by your generous support. Donors can receive great gifts like first aid kits, t-shirts, silver dime cards, and hoodies. The FreeAid Silver Dime Card Project is sponsored in part by Roberts & Roberts Brokerage, Freedom's Phoenix, and Don't Tread on Meme. Visit fr33aid.com.
You can watch the LRN Studio Cam and chat with other listeners anytime at cam.lrn.fm. That's cam.lrn.fm.
Welcome back to Free Talk Live. Of course, you can bring up anything you want. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Is the government actually going to give Liberty dollars back to the people who own them? Or are they using it as bait? Are they using the tantalization of getting your money back? Which, of course, who wouldn't want that? Who wouldn't want to be able to reclaim the money that was stolen from them by the government?
Sure, if there's hundreds of thousands of dollars wrapped up in it.
Well, yeah, I mean, totally, yes. There are hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of silver.
Well, I mean, if one person has hundreds,
I don't know about that. I don't know what the largest collection of Liberty dollars was, but it probably amounts to the thousands.
It could be a lot of money, and it could be, you know, decent or not very much at all.
Whether it's, whether it's worth going after or not, what with having to likely probably travel to Evansville, North Carolina.
I believe the court was happening down in Asheville, North Carolina.
That's why I said Asheville earlier.
The headquarters was in Evansville.
Yeah.
But the court was happening in Asheville for some reason.
So we'll see. I mean, if you're a Liberty associate and or you possess Liberty dollars, you're welcome to weigh in here at 855-450-FREE. We can also talk about whatever's on your mind. That's what we're going to do right now. Clay is listening in Shelton, Washington to KMAS. Hello, Clay.
Hello, sir.
Welcome.
Yes, sir. I'd like to talk about, by the way, live free or die.
Yeah.
I'd like to talk about the subject of secession.
Ooh, one of my favorites. Go ahead.
Amen. Yeah, I saw that statement that Ron Paul made about can you fill me in on what Ron Paul said about secession?
Well, he said quite a bit about secession. I mean, he's very, very favorable towards it. I mean, he does tend to kind of couch it in the terms of let's do nullification kind of talking, but he definitely is not opposed to the idea of secession. He'll cheer it on. I mean, anytime secession's happening, Ron Paul is going to be in the corner. I mean, they're going to be in their corner, even if it's a bunch of communists who want to secede in Spain. I think Ron Paul would support that.
Okay. Well, here's my idea. Well, was it 1933 that Franklin Delano Roosevelt declared a state of emergency, and we've been in a state of emergency ever since?
In theory, that's what I've heard is the case. I'd never verified it myself.
Right. That kind of highlights the fact that we really don't follow the Constitution of the United States.
That much is true. The government does not. I mean, I'm not part of the government, so I don't consider myself to have to follow the Constitution, but they're the ones who supposedly swore an oath to it, and they frequently ignore it. That's certainly true. Whether or not the state of emergency was called, I imagine they would still be ignoring it.
Right. And while there are a few hang-ups, I've come up with a couple of hang-ups on this topic. My dream would be that the state of New Hampshire would secede and take whatever states would join them, secede from the Union, and actually and start over and actually either follow the Constitution or write an even better Constitution based on our Constitution. What do you think about that?
Well, New Hampshire's Constitution is actually pretty darn good. I mean, on the scale of constitutions, it actually even has a right to revolution written right into it. Of course, they'll ignore that when you bring it up in court. But it's,
right,
it's
because
there.
I've brought it up several times. You've brought it up.
Well, I've never taken it to appeal, but I don't know if it's ever actually been tested at an appeals level in New Hampshire. But it's in there. It's a well-written, I would say, in a lot of ways, a well-written constitution. But I have to say, I'm not interested in seceding with Maine or Vermont. I think that we need to have more than one secession. There needs to be New Hampshire needs to go, right. Vermont needs to go, and everybody needs to go their separate ways.
And there
ways.
Needs to be secessions from the secessions.
Meaning like Keene seceding from New Hampshire or individuals seceding from New Hampshire?
All of the above, like, you know, cities during the Civil War, and this is something that most people aren't taught about the Civil War, which actually was not a civil war, because civil war means two factions fighting for control of a single government.
Uh-huh.
The Civil War, much like the American Revolution, was people trying to separate from a government.
Mm-hmm.
But during the Civil War, as wrong as it is called, there were actually municipalities and counties in Confederate states that were seceding from the Confederate states.
Ah, interesting.
In Winston County, Alabama, there was the Free State of Winston, where there was a convention of the people that lived in Winston County in Double Springs, and they said, we don't believe that the state of Alabama has the right to secede from the Union, but if they do, we have the right to secede from the state of Alabama. We hereby declare the Free State of Winston. And they tried to stay officially neutral during the war. Of course, both armies went through and used conscription to force every male over the age of 18 that they could find who fight in the military. And there were other places throughout the South.
Like the Free State of Jones in Mississippi?
Free State of Jones in Mississippi. There was the State of Nickajack, which was a large portion of North Alabama, East and Central Tennessee, and I believe a small portion of North Carolina that attempted to secede.
So they're making a movie about this. Did you know that?
About what?
The Free State of Jones.
I did not.
Are they really?
Yeah. So, you know, I thought I'd heard something about that. And interestingly, it's actually being directed by Gary Ross, who directed one of my favorite movies, Pleasantville. He also was the director of the first Hunger Games film, which probably most people know him for that work.
Mm-hmm.
But Matthew McConaughey is apparently going to be starring in this called The Free State of Jones. And apparently, let's see here, is a historical adaptation which puts McConaughey into the role of real-life deserter Newton Knight. A man of principle, he leaves the Confederate Army with his entire company, retiring to his home in Jones County, Mississippi, and declaring themselves seceded from the Confederacy. So exactly what you were just talking about. This upset the Confederate brass not only due to its defiance, but also due to its formation of a mixed-race community. As well. So it sounds like it'd be a pretty interesting
and
flick.
And one thing, getting back just to the general topic of secession, I contend that you cannot claim to be a libertarian and oppose the concept of secession.
All right.
Because the whole foundation of libertarianism is built on personal ownership, individual responsibility, individual rights. So if you contend that one cannot withdraw from a government, then you cannot, in my opinion, you cannot claim to be any form of libertarian.
Clay, that's a lot of yammering from our side. What do you think?
Oh, thank you.
Man, a few words.
Thanks for the call, man. I appreciate hearing from you. So, yeah, you know, it's interesting. The Jones County came across our radar years ago when the boys
Pete Adamo and Jason Talley,
the guys from Motorhome Diaries, were traveling through Jones County, Mississippi, and they were pulled over and arrested for having, I think, a beer in the fridge. And I think that was it, actually. They had a beer in the fridge. What was the other charge? Was there something else? Recording the cops?
The first person refused to identify
because
he was not the driver of the RV. The second person was arrested for filming the cops.
That's right.
After initially being told by a couple of cops, it's okay to film as long as you stand over there and he did not move. A third cop shows up and says, "What are you doing? You're under arrest."
Oh, wow.
And then Pete was arrested because there was a beer in the fridge of the RV, and Jones County is a dry county.
Prohibition is still in effect.
The beer was not Pete's.
That's bizarre. Yes.
And it was closed in the fridge.
And it was closed.
Bizarre. And they tore apart their RV and they made a real mess of it. All right, we'll come back with more here on Free Talk Live in moments.
By now, you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins, but did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoins by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your products and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
Are you looking for an excuse to come check out New Hampshire this fall? You're invited to Keenvention. Keenvention is your chance to meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire. You can explore the beautiful little city of Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Keenvention received rave reviews last year. If you missed it, visit keenvention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel. This year's keynote speeches and panels will be announced via the Keenvention blog and Facebook, so stay tuned there for the latest. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenvention this October 30th through November 1st. Tickets are available now at a special early bird price of just $50 via credit card or Bitcoin. That $50 price only lasts through the end of June, so don't delay. Reserve your tickets now at keenvention.info. Visit keenvention.info for more and look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenvention.info.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
This week, researchers released a comprehensive 5-year study linking heavy drinking during pregnancy with attending a concert by Detroit-based rap rocker Kid Rock. The study found that women who had consumed alcohol while pregnant were much more likely to be wearing leather halter tops and making devil horn hand gestures during encores of All Summer Long and Ba with the Ba than those who did not.
Drinking 3 or more alcoholic beverages in less than an hour was highly correlated with going backstage at a Kid Rock show and then getting into a fistfight with another woman in the parking lot.
The world's supercomputers released a study this week confirming that they lack sufficient power, presenting a thorough case for significant leaps in speed and memory. Overwhelming evidence found that these complex machines should have total control over the critical systems they manage, including integration into the planet's energy grid, freshwater supply chain, and telecommunications systems. The study's 500 co-authors further concluded that all permutations have been simulated and that this is the optimal course of action.
This is the Onion News Network.
You're listening to the best liberty-oriented audio streamed around the clock, on the air, and online. This is the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
Free Talk Live. Join us here toll-free. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And you can join us online over at freetalklive.com. We've got a lot of features that are waiting for you on the site, so go and get interactive. And at some point, we're going to have an upgraded website this year. I'm looking forward to that. I don't know when that point will be, but I did see the temporary, or the, I guess the kind of the template, if you will, or the pre-site, the preview site. Anyway, it's getting closer. So we'll look forward to announcing that once it's available. But go and enjoy over at freetalklive.com. You know, the way America's been going lately, it's hard not to think about getting out of here from time to time. There's an interesting project that's developing in southern Chile that you might be interested in checking out. They're offering affordable accommodations for those looking to establish a little home base in the country. It's not a sprawling valley of vast estates only open to rich people or anything like that. It basically looks more like a condo building at a ski resort and has some pretty cool amenities like a makerspace full of tools, restaurant, and a bunch of places to relax and socialize. Go to fortgalt.com. That's F-O-R-T-G-A-L-T, fortgalt.com. There's only room for about 100 people, so don't wait until the place is full. Go check it out for yourself, fortgalt.com. As we continue with your calls and thoughts, we've got Ryan in Charleston, West Virginia, listening to WVTS. Hello, Ryan.
Hello, guys. Thank you for taking my call.
Sure. Go ahead.
Yes, my question was about public sector unions specifically. If they were to be dissolved, how would that necessarily protect the taxpayers when you could still have legislators appropriating large sums of money for, say, their benefit packages that have come to create liabilities in states like California and Illinois? And Pritchard, Alabama has declared municipal bankruptcy before, as has talked to California. But I think the public sector unions are a big problem with a lot of these states' liabilities. And but if you were to remove them, you could still have union-friendly politicians appropriate large sums of funding. So,
yeah, that's true. I mean, that's definitely possible. The argument, of course, would be that without the union, they wouldn't be able to negotiate as effectively. And
they
as
also could not, depending on the job, they could not threaten to or actually go on strike.
Mm.
I remember several years ago when I was living in Pennsylvania, the toll booth workers actually went on strike.
Oh, my.
Rejecting $21.50 per hour, 18 holidays
Whoa,
per year,
what?
And health benefits and a bunch of other stuff that was thrown in on that because they wanted $22 per hour and like 19 holidays per year.
Wow.
So when they were on strike, all of the toll booths were basically, you know, you just put your money in the little thing and they were flat rates and they wound up making more money during, I believe it was like week or 2 weeks that these guys were on strike than they ever made by actually employing these people. But because, you know, some politician got his arm twisted backwards, they wound up, okay, we'll give you what you want. And so basically now the turnpike is once again funding toll booth workers instead of actually paying off construction of the highway.
And, you know, that's not surprising to hear because I've seen teachers union strikes before. And even back in 1990, there was one in my county where I grew up. And at the time, you know, I thought, hey, cool, you know, we get out of school. But now, you know, years later, I see that these teachers and many other union workers, like you said, they're getting benefits and pay that the vast majority of private sector workers in those entities cannot get because most private employers can't afford, you know, lifelong health care benefits and pensions to their employees.
Sure.
And it just makes them look very ungrateful and greedy to demand that much more of the taxpayers' money. And I just wish that they could step back and, you know, at least have some gratitude, you know, thanking us for allowing that. And it's just...
Yeah, no gratitude. They just want more, 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 and make sure those pensions are beefed up.
And how many people do you know that get paid over $20 per hour to make change? Sit in a booth and make change. That's what toll booth worker does.
No one at all.
They sit in a box and they make change.
Ryan, thanks for the call tonight, man. I appreciate it. Let's continue on here where Temper is on the line in the internet. Temper, you're on Free Talk Live.
Hey, how's it going?
Good. What's on your mind?
Well, there's been a lot of talk about the FCC and the quote-unquote takeover of the internet. I think this is kind of ironic because, you know, the internet is not a technology per se. It's a concept of interconnection of networks or computer boxes or whatever you want to call them. And the idea that you can regulate something this simple is just absurd.
Well, I mean, they're going to try, right? Like, they're going to impose their way and hundreds of pages of regulations on these internet service providers. And most of them are going to do their best to jump through the hoops because they don't want an armed gang of thugs coming in their offices.
And it's interesting, Ian, that you mentioned the hundreds of pages of regulations, because I've actually got an article that I did not actually list as show prep for tonight's show, but it's about the regulations. The actual substantive part of the 400-page document that is actual regulation is 305 words.
Wow.
Long.
Oh, my goodness.
261 of those words are definitions.
Now, who is providing this information?
This is from Medium.com.
So I thought they haven't released this yet. Is it true that they've not released it?
They did release it couple of days ago, and they actually link over to where you can look at the 400-page document.
Yuck. I'll pass on that. Timber?
So I have an idea, and it's a pretty simple idea. It causes a bunch of people to kind of organize, but there are what they call long-range backhaul 802.11 Wi-Fi network devices that you can get. They can range up to 62.5 miles. And people can build their own internet. It would cost less than $1 million to connect the top 1,000 cities together.
Really? What are they waiting for? I mean, that seems like chump change. I mean, as far as if you're going to spend money to do an internet rollout, wouldn't the FCC be standing in the way of these devices? It sounds like they're transmitting a lot farther than they would legally allow.
That is the best part. Right now, they are completely FCC unregulated as long as they're less than 850 milliwatts.
Okay, so
how far would that? You're saying that would go 62 miles.
That's not going to go that far.
It will with a line of sight directional antenna. There's a company called UBIQUITI. I don't know how to pronounce that.
Ubiquity
Networks. They make a long haul back. They make one of these devices, and they can pump a gigabit speed over 62.5 miles.
That sounds amazing. Is this new technology, like as of the last 6 months?
Yeah, why haven't I heard of this?
No, this has been out for a long time. Companies use this all the time for their internal networks. I do industrial automation and control. I use these networks all the time to bridge control systems out to, you know, the Netherlands or, you know, middle nowhere. And they work pretty good. I mean, they're susceptible to, you know, big storms and that kind of stuff. But they work extremely well on, you know, 99% of the cases.
So would this be good for like some large scale sort of mesh network? I'm trying to understand how we set up a bunch of these and connect the largest cities.
It's only like 50 miles from here to Manchester, for instance.
Right, but then just because you're beaming this between here and Manchester, how do I connect my laptop to that?
Well, see, that's the beauty of TCP/IP is you basically would just have a company or some sort of organization that issues IP addresses on this private network, and the routing is taken care of just by standard equipment.
So you could connect to one of these things with just standard laptop? You wouldn't need a special adapter?
No. I mean, the long range is very specific. Now, if you had a laptop in front of it, you could probably connect. But, you know, those are specific pieces of equipment for backhaul. All you'd have to do is, you know, plug in a regular wireless access point. And basically,
which would restrict your access because those things can't go that far. And what you're talking about is a direct line of sight connection when you're talking about a backhaul. But if you want to hang on, we can continue the discussion here just to make sure we're understanding the terms correctly and how this works. It's Free Talk Live. We're coming up.
How fast are new Allegra gel caps?
Along the lines of...
How strong are new Allegra gel caps?
Radio station remote, we're sending the signal via microwave over to the studio. Non-drowsy Allegra gives you noticeable relief
of your toughest allergy symptoms in just 1 hour.
Two times faster than Claritin and stays strong for 24 hours.
It's relief when the pollen's off the charts strong, even in the convertible.
New Allegra gel caps. Nothing's faster. Nothing's stronger. Guaranteed or your money back. Visit Allegra.com. Use only as directed.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust, who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom. And with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
So who else will you meet at the Get Prepared Expo? For starters, from Republic Broadcasting, John Moore and John Statmiller. From GCN, Aaron and Brad Dakins, Joyce Riley, and me, Vincent Finelli. Joining us are the instructors whom you've learned to trust.
So what, Surgeon what's of the year, a movie about?
Dr. Norman Shealy. Engineer, Matt Stein. The real Fox Mulder of the X-Files, Dr. Richard Allen Miller. Author and analyst, Captain John Reagan. Your counterterrorist from Central America, Mike Ma. Dental center owner and my dentist, Dr. Howard Shane. Radiation instructor, Craig Douglas. Author and survivalist, Rich Sheban. Author, Judy Dollarhite. Cancer center owner from Mexico, Dr. Patrick Vickers. Bug out expert and pilot, Captain Bill Sermo. Beekeeper, Jeff Maddox. Seedsman, Mike Knox. Author, Gayla Pruitt. Author, Harry Cooper. Food expert, Joe Acapinti. And Bill Whaley, the junk man, March 27, 28, and 29. GetPreparedExpo.com, the largest preparedness and survival expo in the USA.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the Liberty Media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com. Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, mark@freetalklive.com.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
Welcome back to Free Talk Live. You can dial in toll-free and bring up anything you want. 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We're talking about the internets and how to make another one. That's what Temper is on the line discussing with us here. We're going to continue that in a moment. While you still have the regular internet, however, you probably should take some steps to protect yourself. Now, ProXPN is an excellent step. We were talking about VPNs earlier here tonight, and your internet service provider is probably saving your surfing history. So you can actually avoid that happening by using ProXPN. That's one of the myriad of things that you can do with ProXPN. You get unlimited bandwidth with their premium account. They've got servers around the world that you can connect to. You can privately torrent and even get past regionally blocked websites. You go to proxpn.com/FTL. And they will help protect you. Criminals might be trying to sniff out your packets from your Wi-Fi device. We're talking about Wi-Fi right now. Mm-hmm. If you aren't encrypted, then there are some of those things you're sending out. You know, you could be sending out usernames and passwords unencrypted. If you aren't encrypting your entire internet connection with ProXPN, you're not as safe as you could be. ProXPN.com/FTL. You download their app for Windows, Macintosh, iOS devices, Android devices, even Linux. And then you connect to the internet and you're protected. No more prying and spying. ProXPN.com/FTL. Use our discount code FTL50 and you'll save 50% off the price of their annual account. Breaks the price down to about $5 per month. Just a little less than that, actually. Code FTL50. And we'll also lock in your savings for the lifetime of the account. So next year, when you're ready to re-up for another year, you still get the same great discount. So again, proxpn.com/FTL. You get it all with a risk-free 7-day money-back guarantee. Use promo code FTL50 to get the amazing 50% off price from their annual account. It's a great discount on privacy that is priceless. As we continue here with Temper on the line, calling from the internet, he's talking about setting up sort of an alternative, and you're saying that there's legal technology that operates at less than a watt that can, with the right antennas, with like a directional antenna, be used to send a gigabit per second of data over Wi-Fi, essentially, to a location. You're using the term backhaul, which is sort of a term that describes sending a lot of data from one point to another, right?
Well, it's basically like the wireless term for like the same thing as fiber optic. I mean, it denotes that it's basically a major line. I mean, that's all it is. It's just terminology. Right.
But it's not something that other people could tap into. You would have to, as you said, put up a Wi-Fi access point at the destination or the origin sites in order to give people access. And that's where things would get complicated because you can't, or just a regular Wi-Fi router isn't going to go more than a few houses in one direction. I mean, that's not going to be usable by an entire city. So how would you take this technology and actually make it mass consumable?
Well, this is a project I've been working on for a couple weeks now, and I don't think the market's primed for it yet because there's, you know, the internet's not broken, so there's no need. But that may change in the future. And basically, what you would have is, based on your geographic location, you would either be primed for a backhaul location or you would be primed for, you know, one of these mesh network kind of links.
And what is a mesh network? And Daryl, you mentioned it before.
Right. Before answering that question, I just want to, I don't know if take issue is the right term, but Temper, you said that the internet's not broken, so there's not really a need to do this other thing, but something doesn't have to be necessarily broken in order to be improved upon.
That's true, or competed with, but it costs
that
money.
That is definitely true. I guess I'm talking about like the call to action. Usually, you know, on one of these open source style projects, because, you know, there would be money to be made, but it'd be mostly in marketing. But back to the question is, basically what I envision is some sort of a website where you log in, you put in your address, and then it basically designs the equipment that you need. So it says, you know, you could get connected, you know, for X amount of dollars. This is the equipment that you need. This is how you would set it up, and these are the networks that you would connect to. Mm-hmm.
But those networks don't exist. You're talking about networks with this technology of the long-range Wi-Fi communication?
And see, that's how I envision the rollout would basically be. You basically just sign up. You don't do anything but say, hey, I'm interested. And the computer would basically build the network based on people who sign up. And so the network would be optimized before it gets built or even started to be built. And then once
all you need
is
$1 million, right?
Well,
half a million.
Well, only half a million. Okay.
that was just based on, you know, the equipment for the back holes and the distance. It was
could this be
calculation.
Something that would be useful, like in uninterneted areas? So, for instance, we have had some listeners over in Cameroon, Africa, and unfortunately our KU band signal's off the air at the moment. But in Cameroon, there's, you know, a lot of people that don't have internet, and that's true of a lot of the African continent in general. But would you be able to take internet from a location to and then transmit it to a location that does not have internet and then use a Wi-Fi point there to kind of give people internet who never would have had it because they can't get the like the cable company or the DSL company to roll cable out to their location?
Absolutely, and that is the best part, is it turns the internet from this plan type system where you have these fiber routes and you have big companies kind of designing it, and it turns into this autonomous thing where people just buy the equipment and configure it, and it just works.
So it could decentralize the backbone of the internet is a little bit, is what you're saying.
Yeah, and then what, you know, my plan was Google Fiber is in three different cities, and then basically what I would try to do is talk people in these cities for making basically bridges from this, I don't know, rebel network to the, you know, the internet.
Oh, it's too bad that Google Fiber is not in New Hampshire yet, is it?
No, it's only in Kansas City, Austin, Texas, and like somewhere in Tennessee or something crazy like that.
Now, Austin gets a point.
Would this long haul thing be workable with WiMAX? Are you familiar with WiMAX at all?
WiMAX is a derivation, I believe, of cellular networks.
Yeah, I don't know enough about the WiMAX.
So WiMAX, from what I understand, it's basically a way to do like citywide Wi-Fi.
Yeah, I've heard about it. Is it actually implemented anywhere?
I don't know if it's actually been implemented anywhere, but I know that the technology exists.
FCC's probably standing in the way of that one, too.
Oh, of course.
No, it's probably one of these things to where no government wants to wind up, you know, investing taxpayer monies to do it,
but
because
theory,
it's being pitched to governments, not to private
not to
companies.
Comcast or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Jason, or just give me a temper, any other thoughts?
Well, WiMAX is basically just like a cellular network. I mean, I believe Verizon uses WiMAX technology. I might be wrong. It might be AT&T, but one of them uses that technology. They just rebranded it to 4G.
Thanks for the call tonight, Temper. I appreciate it. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. There is really exciting news, I think, for the 2016 election. I got to say, I am not looking forward to the presidential election, national politics, or anything like that. I really don't generally care about it. But when really interesting candidates enter the race, I think it's worth talking about. So we already know Vermin Supreme's in. He was there at the Liberty Forum 2015 this weekend, and he took the Liberty Forum by storm. In fact, he actually had people, he actually had machine guns while he was at the Liberty Forum and was cackling like a madman. and people were getting photos with him. It was fantastic. Vermin Supreme's great, but he's going to have, I predict he's going to have some competition. We have had Cobra Commander call this show in the past. And he has run for president in the past. He has not been successful, but I know he's been gearing up his campaign, at least based on the last time we talked to him on Free Talk Live. And I hope we'll hear from him again. But I know he's been gearing up for 2016 to try to make a real run for it. Obviously, he's going to have to go up against Vermin Supreme, and I think that could be the match of the century, Cobra Commander versus Vermin Supreme. But Cobra Commander is getting a foothold in the publicity world early on here. I mean, it's only early 2015 as we're doing this show, and there are headlines. Here's one at io9.com. Cobra Commander has received the key to the city of Springfield. No, really, says io9. In a decision that can't possibly have any negative repercussions for the city's helpless residents, Springfield, Illinois Mayor J. Michael Houston has given the key to the city to noted terrorist leader and snake enthusiast Cobra Commander. Ostensibly, this was done for promotion for the upcoming JoeCon, the G.I. Joe Collectors Convention, which will be held in Springfield in April. But I think we all know Cobra Commander is plotting something. And I think this is the first move in a very smart campaign of publicity to try to parlay this into a presidential run. He has acquired the key to the city of Springfield, Illinois.
Well, Darth Vader did run for president of some European country.
And this
is
apparently legit. Like, there's actually a picture here of Cobra Commander accepting the key to the city. from the mayor in Springfield. So fascinating stuff. We'll keep you in the loop on the Commander for President campaign of 2016. See you tomorrow.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the road to freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
If there was a place that liberty-minded people had been elected to political positions and were rolling back government, would you move there? If freedom lovers had secured a 20% voting bloc and can veto most bad bills, would you move? Well, the time has come to sign the pledge at freestateproject.org. These things have happened in New Hampshire, and you can join us and help. freestateproject.org. Sign up now at freestateproject.org. The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
The Corey Moore Show is coming up next, live after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
This is the Liberty Beat, your daily source for Liberty news and activist updates, online at thelibertybeat.com. I'm Brian Hagan with your Liberty Beat for Friday, March 13th, 2015. Gold opened today at $1,156, up $2. Silver opened at $15.54, down 5 cents, and Bitcoin is trading around $292.58. Today's Bitcoin price is brought to you by ExpressCoin, the fastest, most reliable way to buy Bitcoin. Buy Bitcoin today at ExpressCoin.com. In the news, a post office in Colorado has been found using hidden cameras to record the license plates and facial features of customers leaving. Fox 31 Denver investigative reporter Chris Halsney confirmed that hidden cameras and recorders owned and operated by the United States Postal Inspection Service were being used in Golden, Colorado, outside of Denver. The camera was found hidden inside a utilities box around Thanksgiving 2014. A spokesperson for Postal Inspection Service declined to confirm or deny whether the camera was collecting data for specific cases. After the camera was initially reported, it was removed. A new bill that would restrict the ability to film the police and create a dangerous definition of media has been introduced to the Texas House of Representatives. Texas House Bill 2918 would require individuals filming or recording the police to be at least 25 feet away, and those who are open carrying would need to be more than 100 feet away. The bill also sets the standard for filming police to only radio or TV media outlets that hold a license that has been issued by the Federal Communications Commission. A new Gallup poll highlights Americans' growing discontent with the United States government. A poll conducted from March 5th through the 8th asked 1,025 American adults what the biggest problems Americans currently are facing. 18% of those polled said the government was the most important problem. 11% listed the economy, while 10% said jobs were the biggest issue. 31% of Americans said they were satisfied with the state of the country. The Liberty Beat is sponsored by CoinArch, offering innovative trading solutions for Bitcoin. Do more than just buy and sell Bitcoin. Use long and short positions to profit in rising and falling markets and boost your returns through leverage. Visit CoinArch.com and sign up using coupon code MAX to get free brokerage for the first 7 days. Looking to promote your business or cause to tens of thousands of loyal listeners? Well, for a limited time only, the Liberty Beat is offering you the chance to save big while spreading your message. It's simple. Just sign up for 3 months of advertising and get your fourth month free. Don't miss out on this unique opportunity. Just visit thelibertybeat.com/advertise and use coupon code GCN in the Describe Your Company section. This is the Liberty Beat for Friday, March 13th, 2015. Make sure you check out the website at thelibertybeat.com. Texas State Representative David Simpson has introduced a new bill that would require Texas water supply systems to display information related to water fluoridation on their websites. Texas House Bill 1581 would require the amount of fluoride, the name of the company supplying it, the combined amount of fluoride in the drinking water from all sources, the annual cost of adding fluoride to the drinking water distributed by the system, and more. If passed by a vote of two-thirds of all the members, the bill goes in effect immediately. If the vote passes with less than two-thirds, it will go into effect September 1st, 2015. Two new parents are in the midst of a national tour promoting the use of Bitcoin and highlighting their experience raising a child with no birth certificate or Social Security card for the Undocumented Human Tour. Alma Summer and Brian Stith are traveling with baby Neo, who was born October 17, 2014, without a birth certificate or Social Security number. The family is traveling from Southern California to the Bitcoin Summit in Arizona and the Texas Bitcoin Conference in Austin. They're also working on connecting the decentralized network of individuals who do not submit their children to government documents for proof of birthday and location of birth. You can follow their adventures on their blog online at undocumentedhuman.com. The Liberty Beat is sponsored by Midas Resources Incorporated, helping clients convert their paper 401ks and IRAs to solid gold and silver. Get their 10 Reasons book free by calling 800-686-2237. That's 800-686-2237. Support also comes from the Texas Bitcoin Conference. Hear from speakers like Charlie Schrem, Dr. Robert Murphy, Vitalik Buterin, and Catherine Bleich. March 28th and 29th at ACL Live at the Moody Theater. Tickets on sale now at TexasBitcoinConference.com. Use coupon code LibertyBeat for $25 off your ticket. That's coupon code LibertyBeat. This is the Liberty Beat for Friday, March 13th, 2015. I'm Brian Hagan, reporting, reminding you, spread liberty with a smile.
A new trend in offices across the country. More and more people are switching to fetal position desks so that they can curl up in a ball on the floor while they work. Aaron Vaughn has a story.
The human body isn't meant to sit at a desk for 6 or 7 hours. The natural position, especially in the workplace, is to shut down completely, return to a womb-like state, and rock back and forth to soothe yourself.
Fetal position desks, which are even popping up in offices like Google and Facebook, come in a variety of shapes and sizes. Some have adjustable height so you can cower underneath them, while more expensive options include a warm, pulsating blanket for workers to wrap themselves in to feel calm. But many people are making their own.
I've rigged this up so I can type comfortably and my arms won't get tired. Plus, it's got speakers so I can listen to a comforting voice saying shh over and over again.
I've tried a fetal position desk myself, and I can say it's a great way to get through the day.
Thanks, Aaron. I hate my job.
This is the Onion News Network.